Welcome to the Role Play Podcast with Matt and Beard, where we discuss video games, tabletops, pen and paper RPGs, and also other sources of entertainment media. We discuss their design, philosophies, or we just comment on about anything, really. With music provided to us by the very talented Brayton. Please welcome your hosts, Beard and Matt, because it starts in 3, 2, 1.
Hello, welcome back, everybody, to another episode of the Role Play Podcast, episode 58. As always, I'm your host, Beard, joined always with the magnificent Matt.
Hello, traveler. My name is Falkenhoof. Are you ready to begin?
Wow. we're really scraping the bottom of the barrel as far as internet references are concerned. Wow.
Yes, if you want to get it, folks, after the show, if you do it before, I will shoot you. But if after the show, you can search on YouTube for Adventure Call, and then you will,
kill Jesta. All right, let's get right into it, because we got lots of comments. Some of them are really long. I'd like to start out by saying it's awesome.
We really do love them. Before, of course, we go into comment, I'm just going to give, what we'll talk about today. We will, basically, there's a study that came out this week that confirms that games indeed do not make you sexist. Okay, well, it's great that it was confirmed. But then, of course, plenty of people who argued the other way around moved their goalposts. It was basically like, I wish I owned a company that moves goalposts, because I would be like multimillionaire. I would be so rich. I wouldn't have to do this fucking podcast anymore. No, I'm kidding. of course, we're going to talk about...
This fucking podcast. We love it. What are you talking about?
I hate it. I despise it. Why am I even here? Okay, no, but... I'm going to keep going. But we're going to talk about hashtag Sadpuppies and the Hugo Awards. It's basically... I'm going to talk more about it later. We're going to talk also about hashtag Areyoublocked, which is basically a movement against blog bots in general, which, you know, is bound to reach more people than Gamergate, because lots of people happen to be against fucking censorship. We're going to talk about legal dimensions really briefly. This whole thing about this Polygon journalist that basically was like, hey, I know that this game's going to get released, and I'm going to just take the name of Liquid Dimensions, the website, and then I'm going to make it link to my article, just for fun. It's a joke, guys. We're going to talk about Ken Levine that was attacked for saying that there's more to characters than, you know, just the color of their skin. And a bunch of other shit. And, of course, the anti-gamer segment, which, by the way, there was a comment by, I think it was Red Knight, who said, like, we need a new name for this section. And I kind of sort of agree. I think Beard might read that comment. I'm not sure.
I actually didn't copy it.
It doesn't matter. We're going to talk about the other one, though, of course, and then video game news, and we're going to talk a little bit about Dungeons & Dragons, more specifically our Pathfinder adventure that we're kind of playing. It's going to be a fun story time at the end of the episode. All right, so first of all, the comments. Let's do it. Let's do this.
So, from the top, we've got Javits, who said, I like you guys, but I was hoping you'd talk about tabletop RPGs. Well, you're in luck, Javits. We're going to talk about it at the end. I just wanted to touch on this really briefly. I realized that when we sat down to talk about the D&D stuff, I brought in a lot of information in a very short time. Because Gamergate has turned into a much bigger thing than we anticipated, it sort of has been overtaking everything else. We find that it is part of the reason why our podcast is getting so popular, so obviously we're going to continue with it. And along with that, I think that I was kind of looking at the roleplay stuff the wrong way. So we're going to try reintroducing it slowly, seeing how everybody likes it. Again, if you want to see more of it, like, thanks, Javits, for letting us know, like, your comment regardless. And everyone else, like, if you like it, if you don't like it, maybe it's just a small minority. Maybe we can work something out that I can just do, like, we can do another show that will just do tabletop stuff on. It's hard to get news. Tabletop stuff comes out notoriously, like, much
slowly.
Slower than...
Yeah. And especially also even... tabletop games, but you know the other ones with the dice, the real, like Catan and that kind of shit, like those type
of games. Yeah, board games and stuff. Yeah.
Board games.
I mean, I'd love to review those too, but again, they're also kind of a bit of an investment, and not only that, but having a full-time job, it's hard to find time to find people in real life to play tabletop games with. Moving right along, sort of along with that one, at FireX726 over Twitter asked, being really liking y'all's podcast, I like that he used y'all, he or she used y'all, and was looking at the older ones, how come y'all stopped with the broad topics? And again, that sort of goes hand in hand. Gamergate, I imagine, also, like to all of us, turned a lot bigger than we expected. Yeah.
And also, it's really hard to, I mean, come up with a new topic every single week. I will definitely try to sneak one from time to time because I do really still like them. It's also, yeah, it's because, you know, there's so many news that come each week that sometimes it's hard to just be like, oh, if I don't talk about this now, I'll never have the chance to talk about it. But, you know, this week I tried to. You know, I still talk about, like, the very important things, but I try to, you know, because, I mean, we've seen it so much, like, just pictures of people claiming that they're for equality and they love everybody, just saying, like, oh, you know what, these people from that movement should probably all die in a fire owned by the Nazis or something, you know? So like, it's almost lost its sheen, so we'll be able to talk more about, you know, other kind of stuff, hopefully.
Yep, definitely. So, moving right along, Hexus 13th says, beard versus beard at, I imagine this is quoting our last episode, 133.45. This is quoting myself. I don't know when we started teaching people this. I don't know what fucking class I missed. Like, whether or not it was post-secondary that we learned this thing where it's like, if you talk about an idea, therefore you endorse an idea. I do totally talk like that. That was my impression of beard. It was pretty spot on.
No, it's actually a real playback that I played in real time.
Yeah, it was incredible. And then the beard versus beard part, he or she then puts a second quote, 2 hours, 9 minutes, 50 seconds. If you're someone's girlfriend and you feel like you're being objectified, make better friends. Now, some of you might be confused as to how those two relate to one another. Let's continue, because Hex, this is about to explain. I was researching feminist theory for about a year before Gamergate. There is no feminist definition of objectification that does not equate to an externalization of internal representations, or put simply, that by thinking or viewing someone as a thing, you lower them to the status of that thing. So I'm going to stop.
What is he saying?
The quote continues. What he's saying is that in feminist, there is no feminist definition of objectification.
Maybe they should work on that.
Yeah. Well, I'm just saying. I disagree, right? But anyways.
Oh, no, there is.
Anyways, that such a radical theory has passed into the mainstream lexicon to the point where Beard uses it unknowingly is a successful reprogramming of thought via memification. Or, if I were to go it on a limb, propaganda. It's to the biggest problem in the universe, and since you hate them so much, go vote on babies!
Yeah, it's a podcast we do listen to.
Yeah, So first of all, thanks for your comment, Hexus. I don't see the beard versus beard thing.
Yeah, I don't know exactly how he contradicts himself. Also, the way you were reading his comment, he sounds a lot like Anita Sarkeesian. And it's not even like, I'm not even trying to take him down and use that as an argument. It's just like, you sound like it, and it's kind of funny. You sound like her, and it's
I love
funny.
How Matt calls people Anita Sarkeesian, and I'm the one who gets all of the hate.
Yeah,
on this
it's funny because I thought I was the one that was gonna be like controversial because I always say shit like, oh, I don't know. Sometimes I do try to whatever, but I do have like stronger opinions. At least that's how I perceive myself. And Beard's always like, well, let's try to look at both sides of the story. And all the comments is like, you know, Beard's a fucking idiot. Like, why does Beard say that?
Much,
I disagree with
much.
That thing Beard said, and I'm like. You know, what about me? I guess everybody loves me. They're like, yeah, Matt, you're a champion.
Yeah.
It's great.
Well, you know what? I don't really care. I mean, to be entirely fair, I guess I get it because I'm always trying to give people the benefit of the doubt, and I do understand why that can frustrate people with more
experience. Such a fucking monster beard.
Well, I get it. But, and as YouTube people have noticed, it is the most vocal people that will post, right? Now, so with this said, Texas, regardless, though I disagree with what you're saying, I appreciate the comment regardless, honestly. Again, I really want to push it just to oppose, again, what SJWs values you're using and stuff. I think the beard versus beard is that you're trying to say, like, where did these terms come from, and that if we're using them, isn't it a little hypocritical? And I would say no, if only because I think that it does work for a even though I know they don't exist, I will still use the word unicorn. Does that make sense? Like, I do think that there is such a thing as objectification, but I don't think putting a character in a video game that has big tits is objectifying all females on Earth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, beard. It's obvious and clearly is the case. Anyways, I'm going to read the next comment by Annan Annan, which I really appreciated. So here's what he says. I don't really buy equating the Mass Effect 3 ending controversy with the Path of Exile. Not Path of Exile, I mean Pillars of Eternity. That's you just said POE in it.
Yeah,
I mean, it confuses me.
I actually was going to say that,
too. The Pillars of Eternity controversy. Claiming that something is transphobic implies that it is causing social damage outside of the game, whereas having a bad ending is only relevant within the game world. There's a big difference between your game is promoting the murder of trans women in the real world, fix it, and your game's ending is shit, fix it. And I have to totally fucking agree with what he said. I do think it's probably very different.
I do, and I don't think that I...
Because it is something we overlooked. You know, sometimes when you get stuck in all those arguments. No, it's really true because they do claim that because this joke is in the game, somehow it will like hurt real trans women, and it's like total bullshit. Basically, they're saying because basically the critique of Mass Effect is just like your game. And I just to be clear, I don't agree with neither of them. Like, I don't think they should have existed or that you should change. What an artist makes, but I mean, one is definitely more legitimate than the other. It's just like, I critique your game, it's shit, maybe you should, I don't know, I don't necessarily agree with fix it or whatever, but I mean, it's still better than implying, like, just that, you know, this thing in your game hurts real people, I'm not gonna bring any evidence, and you should change it because of that.
Maybe I'm just not quite seeing it, but I think my point was more so against sort of, like, when the internet screams at people to change things, it's pretty much the same thing, whether or not it's... Because to me, I see what you're saying. I see that the two of them have different points, but to me, it is the same thing. There's something that you did that you don't agree with. It's just two different groups. So on one hand, there's a bunch of people that say that this thing is transphobic, change it. And then on the other side, there's a bunch of people who are dissatisfied with Mass Effect.
Like I said, I do think both are negative things, but I mean, they're clearly not the same. Like, they're not on the same level. You know, it's kind of like a slider. They're both in, like, the shit area. It's just like one...
Why? I think would they're be more both legitimate. Ridiculous. I think they are both ridiculous, just like Batgirl and whatever. It's just bowing to what... Well, maybe I'm just missing it. I just see it as exactly the same thing.
It's because one does not imply real-world harm without evidence. That's basically the difference for me.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I don't know, but maybe it's just to me then, but I don't see this Pillars of Eternity that big. Like, I don't think we'll ever see a news thing about, like...
Nobody talks about it anymore. We're just basically talking about it because it was in one of our comments. Nobody...
Right.
Yeah. Nobody...
So, yeah.
Even, that's anyway, how fast
so,
the internet is.
Yeah. Well, again, but Gamergate sort of...
Oh, yeah. Like, Gamergate is that magical.
Yeah. Anyway, so yes, but regardless, thanks for the comment and on and on. So, sort of continuing on with the ME3 thing, I'll go to DarkZ1820's comment. I hated the Mass Effect 3 ending was because everything we worked for to get the best ending, i.e. 100% war asset, and in the end they were somewhat useless by making you choose A, B, or C, while with the option D, kill you anyways, as the war asset does not almost do nothing in the end. Okay, first of all, punctuation.
Yeah!
thank you for the comments. But
syntax and all that stuff, but you know.
This was... almost incomprehensible. Anyways.
I think what he's saying, though, is that basically the reason why he hated the ending of Mass Effect 3 is because it's, like, all the choices you make are mostly pointless and bullshit.
And not just that, but the other reason that I actually brought in this comment was because he mentioned the war asset, which I think is important to bring up, because I did forget about that. Mass Effect 3 basically shoehorned a multiplayer element in, which in order to get basically the best ending that you can, you have to go online and fight.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that.
So, giant pile of fuck, but I basically just brought that up because it's something that I'm mad about. That's pretty much it. Okay, and finally, a giant comment from Red Knight, but I wanted to bring it in. Hey there, guys.
That's a huge comment by Red Knight.
Yeah. Hey there, guys. I am watching your podcast every week, and it is one of the best podcasts on the internet, so keep doing what you're doing. I just want to stop there and say, aw.
I like this guy.
Red Knight.
Clearly, he knows what he's talking about, clearly.
Definitely. Hopefully the subscribers come. But here is one complaint that I have. Well, it's not necessarily a complaint, but more of a question that I hope you guys address. I have noticed that you keep referring to social justice crowd as anti-gamers, which was the first time used by Mundane Matt, if I'm not mistaken. Here's the thing. I never agreed with this term because, one, it's not clear to me what the term is supposed to mean. I mean, some people use it to describe our opposition as people who do not play video games, but then what would be... then be a non-gamer, not an anti-gamer. And even if it is supposed to describe a person who hates games, how do you go about proving any of these two interpretations? Even people like Anita Sarkeesian, who obviously don't play games that she criticizes, can still claim that they play other games and that they do what they do because they love games, and you can't prove that they don't, unless you catch them on camera explicitly saying that they hate video games. Catching SJW on camera or on Twitter saying such things is just not practical due to the sheer number of them, and even if you caught them red-handed, then you can still rationalize it by claiming how they said it was years ago, or they can explain it away like Anita did after being caught on camera basically saying just that. And if you can't prove it, then our opposition would just use it against us, as I have already seen happen a couple of times. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to stop here before we go on to the other parts of this argument. Yep. Matt, would you like to respond to that?
Yeah, I'd like to say the way I see it, using anti-gamers is not necessarily people who are anti-gaming itself, but more like, I guess, just people who don't like gaming as an art. Like, I don't know if I'm making any sense, but basically people who try to censor gaming or who, like, want to change it because it goes against gaming as an art. It prevents it from flourishing. I guess it is, though, like a very generic term, and I wish it was, like, and sometimes, of course, it's not going to fit everybody all the time, because, I mean, it's the name of one of the sections of our show, so it's definitely, it's broad, so sometimes, you know, it's not going to fit some people. So I don't know if you guys, and I'm not really opposed to changing it, so if you guys can think of a better idea, sure, you know, leave it in the comments, we'll be able to see it, or, you know, just tweet it at us or something. But yeah, that's basically why I'm using it.
I personally am actually not opposed to using anti-gamer. I think I understand either what you're saying, and I think your point is exactly correct. However, I think it's not necessarily that they are, like, non-gamers, they are anti-gamers. They do play games, but they're sort of opposed to the idea of it. I know that it doesn't precisely sort of, like, categorize, like, them.
Just as an example, Jonathan McIntosh and being like, fuck violence, or, you know, I like it when in games that the character you play as doesn't listen to your commands that you input. Like, I'm like, what?
Yeah. I mean, and with that said, and I wish I could find a more eloquent way to put this, but it sits really well as an idiom. Like, it's just sort of like as a framework for this group of people, I think. It's sort of like social justice warriors. Like, there was a time that I too actually didn't like using that term because, like, taking it literally, it sounds like someone who fights for social justice, which they're not doing. Like, if the term wasn't used for this, I would love, like, again, it's
humanitarian. It could almost be positive, and some do define themselves as it, but it's like, you know, the emphasis on that word is on warrior, because they just want to fight.
Yeah. So, I don't know. I think it sits well, but yeah, if there's a better term that we're just not aware
of. Yeah, we're open to discussions. I mean, we still like it. If you also just want us to keep it, just tell us too. Like, keep it, bitches.
Definitely. So, this is Red Knight continuing. This here is more important. The term is too broad because there are no doubt some social justice warriors out there who do play video games. So when you do brand them as anti-gamers, you are giving them a way out of the debate, because they can claim to be offended or annoyed by the dishonest way you are describing them. I see what you're saying, but
like,
again,
what I'm saying again is, like, there's no defense against sophistry. I mean, if they don't use that, they're going to use another way. If they want to be disingenuous, you know, people who argue, like, you can't really stop them. The only thing you can do is point out that they're using sophistry and being disingenuous, and it doesn't go against them. You shouldn't try to prevent people from using sophistry against you, because it's almost like they're open. It's like, you know, in the video game terms, it's almost like they're showing their big glowing red weak point, you know, and it's just you just have to hit it.
And I actually...
And not even three times, just once.
the spirit of your comment, Red Knight, I actually do completely agree with. And with this being said, this isn't so much to attack your comment as it is to defend our choices.
Oh, yeah, no, I'm sure you
because
understand.
Like, I personally do think that we should promote more intelligent debates. And again, like, my purpose on this show almost is to be like, let's everybody calm down. And I get a lot of shit for it, which I do appreciate, actually. Like, I want to be criticized so that
donate
I get
to Beard's, you know, Patreon. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah, exactly. Well, this is what a normal person does. Instead of being like, look at all these people yelling at my ideas, I'm not going to change. If I say something stupid, I'd like to be called out on it so that I can change it and become a more intelligent human being.
It's like Ananan's comment. It kind of made me realize, huh, I was kind of sort of a little bit wrong there, and I kind of changed my position regarding it.
Wow, it's like, you know, you're becoming a more intelligent human being or something. But anyway,
it's
so I do agree with the spirit of your comment, Red Knight. But again, when they're calling us goober gators, I'm not worried about understepping them. You know what I mean? Anyways, and third, this is Red Knight's comment, just finishing up here. It makes us look like we are trying to exclude certain people out of our culture, since we are branding them as being anti-gamers just because of their political opinions about social justice. And isn't that exactly what our opposition is trying to achieve by branding us as misogynists and sexists? I understand why it is tempting to use this term, since SJW poison and destroy everything they touch, and I understand social justice fanatics don't need an excuse to behave irrational, but at least don't give them material, just my two cents. Again, I actually...
Same thing as before.
Yeah, I actually totally agree with the spirit of your comment, Red Knight, and I think, honestly, if there were a lot more pro-gamer gators that were like you, well, hopefully it wouldn't be going in this direction. I do think that it's important that we have those loud, strong opinions that are just like, no, you're idiot, shut up.
Yeah.
But I also think that it's important to have those mediators, upon which I believe that you and I are in the same camp.
Yeah, but I mean, again, to the point, like, he's saying, like, we're giving them material. Like, if they're looking to be offended and condemn something on an ideological reason, they'll find reasons regardless.
Right.
So,
and,
you know,
and quite frankly, I think that calling them anti-gamers, again, this is sort of like a social conflict in which there are a lot of, like, new terms and stuff being branded, and very much like our first comment, our Hexus 13th comment about saying, like, because I'm using objectification, therefore I've, like, fallen into the SJW trap.
But it's an idea. I mean...
Yeah, exactly.
It exists as an idea. It might be a stupid or shitty idea that is actually not real, but, you know, it's still an idea.
It's
so
almost
we can discuss
though, well,
it.
And not just that, but it's sort of shorthand. Like, I see what you're saying, but I think that it just makes the conversation more convenient. It's unfortunate. I remember one of the big criticisms that I got, someone freaked out because they were just like, Beard, keep saying that GamerGators do all this shit. Here's the thing about a movement that doesn't have leaders and doesn't have, like, a definitive... start and end point, those people who do say that they're going to blow an AIDS load in Anita Sarkeesian and then finish with hashtag Gamergate are unfortunately part of Gamergate. And trust me...
No, not all of them, though. Some of them are trolls.
Yeah, no. There are some of them that are trolls, but unfortunately, we can't police who is allowed in and out. I think that we've done a wonderful job of the people that break the law to report them to... these individuals and to make sure that they can't shipwreck our own argument. But unfortunately, we can't just like include or exclude whoever we want because our movement is just like, if you want to be part of the movement, you can become part of it, right? Mm. So I don't know. I I actually really appreciate this, Red Knight, and it is something, again, I actually disagree with your last point here, because, again, social justice warriors, I think not all of them, but some of them, do genuinely care about these people who have had, who are not just, like, offended by these ideas, but some people that do feel like they are a minority and they aren't having their voices heard.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, I think we, the point came across, I think,
right.
Yeah.
Sorry, I don't know, just to finish up so that we can move along. Again, so I actually don't think, like, I think that we should try to negotiate in a coherent fashion. I appreciate what you're trying to ask us to do here, but I think Matt and I are both on the same page when we say that I don't think the term anti-gamer is as straightforward.
It's not like we're trying to fucking brand people anti-gamers.
Yeah, saying that they don't play games. But anyways, thanks everyone for your comments. That's it.
All right, cool. So before we go on the main subjects of today, I just have more things to say that I forgot to mention. First, I updated the episodes playlist on the channel, so if people want to... Because I forgot what's the name of this user, but basically it was like, hey, I'm watching your old episodes, and it's hard to find them in order. Could you just update the playlist? And so I did just for him. The funny thing, though, is that the first time I said I would, I forgot, and he's like, hey, buddy, you're breaking my balls. I looked at the episode list again, and it's not updated. And I was like, oh, shit, I'm sorry, I forgot. And then I did it.
Man, and also, you worked so hard. So much
I know. It's insane. Well, dude, it's so repetitive and boring. Anyways, but I did it, you know, because I love you. I love all of you. Anyways.
Just for those of you that are watching Biggest Problem in the Universe, we were talking just before the show. I'm sort of like the Dick Masterson of this show. I've asked Matt to let me help, but I don't.
You can. Please do. Yeah. But anyways, also, we do play, I don't know if you guys are interested, like we do play Pathfinder on Mondays at 5:30, like, which is kind of like Dungeons and Dragons, but sort of similar. I did tweet recently about the last episodes we did, because we're starting a new campaign, so I'm like, if you guys want to maybe follow it, and I don't know, I think if you're interested in that kind of shit, it would probably be super cool. And also at the end of the episode, we're kind of going to start talking a little bit about what happened the last week. If you like Dungeons and Dragons ideas, again, if you like that idea, if you think it might be interesting, tell us you like it. If you're like, no, this is boring, tell us too. So let's start right now with basically there's been against censorship, Frank Cho, which is a wonderful artist. He does amazing fucking art pieces, really impressive. And recently he posted an art piece, kind of like again with Spider-Gwen, basically again regarding that Spider-Girl comic cover. And here it is. I just wanted to show it because it's really cool. All right, it's gonna be on the screen right now. So as you see, he just drew basically Spider-Gwen in the same position that I guess Spider-Woman was, and then you just have Spider-Man looking at her ass being like, whoa, deja vu! And for those who don't know, Spider-Gwen is basically kind of like an alternate reality kind of deal where Gwen Stacy gets bitten by the spider instead of Peter Parker, and it's Peter Parker that dies. So, you know, it's kind of interesting, I guess. I guess it is supposedly, because I don't know, I'm saying that because I haven't read it, but it's like a big social justice-y kind of story or something. But, you know, and if it wasn't, like, fucking embedded in that ideology, I'm sure it would be something that would interest me a lot. But, yeah, basically, people got fucking offended because it's like, oh, my God, you know, it's Peter Parker. He would recognize that ass, you know, I assume. You know, anyways, you know, it's probably a view he already has seen. But yeah, regardless, cool shit. We do have, all right, so basically, first big thing this week is basically there's been a study that was released that confirms that indeed games don't make you sexist.
What?
I was surprised too. I was like, wait a minute, didn't we have that exact kind of fucking study in the 90s that said, you know, that games don't make you more violent? But yeah, I'm going to basically bring up what it said. Study on video game sexism.
Well, with Matt, everything that we watch or read, well, oh, sorry, except if it's in a book, whether it's video games or pornography, makes you do the things that you watch, right?
Yeah, so basically just the important part. And of course, we're going to post... as with any other link, I'll post it in the description after the podcast is over, but this important part said, controlling for age and education, it was found that sexist attitudes measured with a brief scale assessing beliefs about gender roles in society were not related to the amount of daily video games use or preference for specific genre for both female and male players. Implications for research on sexism in video games and cultivation effects of video games in general are discussed. So yeah, basically, and it's a longitudinal study for people who don't know. When you have a study and it says longitudinal, it just means that it was studied for a long time, so several years, so it's not just like... So it's a long-term study. So these generally are more credible because, you know, you study people in a long duration of time. So I assume that, you know, they made lots of, two groups play lots of video games for a long time to see if it would influence them. It appears that it did not at all. So, shocking. And of course, it caused lots of feminists to say, well, we never said that. We never said games cause sexism, you idiots. We just mean that right now games are like, I mean, they're made for sexists. Yeah, that's what we meant. It's totally what we meant.
Wait, what? That's the direction that they went?
Yes. Really? I know. I think, you know, because usually you would either, like, there's two ways I think you would be able to react to that. Either you change your mind, you know, like a normal human being, and you're like, well, I guess science disagrees with my views. I will change my views. Or just you ignore it. You're like, well, I don't like it. It goes against my ideology. I will say it's patriarchal propaganda and just say that video games still cause sexism. But now they're just like,
as an SJW spy, I think what I would have had my
you're a social justice spy, dude.
SJWS.
This podcaster is a spy.
Should have just said that we never said that, but video games are sexist. Yeah. But they don't make people sexist. They just are sexist.
Here's some backpedaling from Athena Hollow and Leigh Alexander. So we have... Gators are passing around a study that says games don't make you sexist. Too bad no one ever said they did. And then Leigh Alexander, nope, they're just marketed aggressively towards people who are sexist already.
What?
and okay, and I have more. We have... even Catherine Cross said something. She said that too, the same thing that Quinn A. Moon. She says, but beyond that, there's a bigger thing to clear up. Neither I nor anyone else worth their salt has said video games causes sexism. Full stop. Oh, it's so glorious. It actually was, in my opinion, games don't cause violence, or ergo they don't have no relationship to sexism. Come now. I don't know what the fuck she's saying there. But and of course, the last one, where we show that, you know, some people that, according to Catherine Cross, aren't worth their salt, did say that it was the case. And of course, it's Anita Sarkeesian. Here's what she said on fucking Colbert. Well, one of the problems with sexual depictions of women in video games is it actually reinforces this cultural myth that women are sexual objects and sexual playthings for male amusement. I think it's a bigger issue to talk about the industry as a whole and how it perpetuates these ideas of sexism and misogyny as opposed to just Grand Theft Auto, for example. So that's what she said. And of course, again, Athena Hollow, too bad no one ever said they did, except Anita Sarkeesian and all of you guys. You know? Oh my god, it's so glorious. It's like,
well, and even from that amazing article from Offworld that we read last week, though this might be a little, like, I don't know, it is a little subjective, I suppose. Like, that seemed to be what the article was implying, or at least that being, like, that the gaming community is just swamped in sexism, therefore, I don't know, it's just...
So much sexism. It's very great. Anyways, next subject of the day, we are basically we're going to talk about Sadpuppies and the Hugo Awards. You might not know exactly what it is. First, the Hugo Awards are awards for science fiction, books, series, everything. And basically, there's been many very known books that got a Hugo Award. That's, you know, how prestigious the title is supposed to be, like shit like Dune, Starship Troopers, Ender's Game, all that kind of stuff. And basically recently people have noticed that it seems that kind of like it was infiltrated by social justice people, and basically mediocre stories were pushed forward because either the person who wrote the story was, like, I don't know, like a different color than white, or had like the transgender identity or that kind of stuff, and the story itself wasn't as good as others. Or the story basically was like basically a love letter to, I guess, the social justice ideals. And these people who write books that, you know, also, of course, are, I guess, sort of eligible to receive Hugo Awards. This year, basically, they asked their fans, like, hey, you know, if you want us to get a Hugo Award, just, like, help us there. And basically, they sweeped all the awards. And that was basically what, you know, we talked, I've shown a tweet by Brianna Wu who said, Gamergate infiltrated the Hugo Awards or something. And it was related to that, basically. and it's kind of ridiculous. Because, of course, now, basically, Sadpuppies are branded as evil white males who, you know, just are racist and sexist. I don't know. Did I see that before? I don't know. It reminds me of something. I don't know exactly if I've seen this before. You know, you're just a group of people being branded racist or sexist because they oppose social justice. Well, I don't know. Maybe I'll never remember. Anyways, here's a thing. There's even Gawker wrote something about that, and I want to kind of just read it a little bit. I'm going to bring it on the screen real quick. All right. No, by the way, as I put this thing on screen, if you want to comment on anything we say or do, we will talk about it in real time. You know, just leave a little comment, we'll see it. So here it is, by Gawker. How Gamergate Radicals seized sci-fi's most prestigious awards. It's us. And I'd like to say that Sadpuppies has nothing to fucking do with Gamergate, by the way. You know, I'd like to be able to say it is, because it's another thing we would have accomplished, but it's just not. It's just like other people who are like, hey, you know, we like good stories, not ideologies. So I'm going to start reading. The Hugos are among science fiction's most prestigious awards. Since the 1950s, they've been awarded to the genre best and brightest icons like Heinlein, Asimov, Ginn and Dick. I don't know. This year, they're just the latest front in Gamergate's war against women and minority fandom. The toxic conservative anti-woman movement that briefly claimed to be about reforming video. They're talking about Gamergate.
When did conservative become an insult? Like, not that I care so much, but it really, like, Red Knight, you want to talk about something that just is sort of coming off as, like, I don't know, calling us, it's like, these communists! Yeah. I don't know. It just seems silly.
I don't know, but if I want to be fair, though, the term socialist is used, I guess, in the same way, kind of in the United States. You know, oh, he's just a socialist. Yeah, but anyways, I don't know, whatever. where was I? I lied with a group of neo-reactionary author in an effort to ensure sci-fi's future looks more like its less diverse past. Oh, these fucking monster, mean to sad puppies! After a 2014 Hugo ceremony during which non-white guy creators Anne Leckie, Mary Robinette Cowell, John Chu, and Cameron Hurley all won Rocket trophies, our sister site, IO9, which is another bullshit site, by the way, don't go on it, hailed it as a sign that a younger generation of diverse writers are becoming central to the genre and helping to redefine and expand it. Oh boy, that's... You know, I don't know, this fucking sentence is like, well, that sounds like newspeak to me, but I'm going to keep reading. A small group of authors and their supporters set out to redefine and shrink the genre back to what they think it should be, mainly white dudes riding space adventures with cool ships and none of that boring crap about prejudice or exploitation. Well, first of all, it's a strawman argument, but I mean, it's like, A, you know, science fiction should be about science fiction and not prejudice and exploitation. I think that they would have a point there. I don't know, maybe, you know, it can be about both, but it definitely should have ships. And I've heard on other podcasts, basically people were talking with them and interviewing them, and they said, no, we just care about good stories. I've read recent stories, and they're all fucking bullshit. They're boring. And of course, then the guy said other crazy shit that I don't agree with, but I mean, he did seem to really just care about good stories, and it's definitely something that, you know, because in Gamergate, we're all about, hey, I want good games, and, you know, people to be able to write about what they want.
And that's the thing, though, right, is that I think
just
warriors, like, when they do write these articles, and I'm not saying all of them, but again, if it wasn't so heavy-handed, because the, like, social justice that they use is sometimes pretty ham-handed. Like, I wish I could remember the name of that game where you're, like, living on the moon or something, that one that I told you about where you can pick from a list of, like, 30 genders. it's really just like, this isn't good storytelling. Like, you can tell a good story about racism or sexism or just generally, like, prejudiced. Again, look at, like, Mass Effect or Dragon Age or whatever. Like, you can tell relatively okay stories about prejudice, but, again, it should still be a good story in its own right, not just, like, here's a subpar sci-fi thing, but you have to say that it's great because a woman is in it. We, like, Metroid wasn't famous because it turned out that there was a girl at the end. That was just, like, the vanilla on top.
Yeah. And I guess that's enough for, because, I mean, we pretty much know where they're going to go, but yeah. I'd like to basically talk about an article from, I guess it's a blog called Monster Hunter Nation, that's by one of the guy who is, I guess, in Sadpuppies, so it will be, I guess, sort of like his point of view. But here's what he says, basically. He says, it's an addendum to yesterday's letter, but, you know, we have all the information already. So he says, yesterday the following media outlets ran an article about the Sadpuppies campaign in which they either directly said or insinuated that it was run and populated by racist straight white males with the goal of keeping sci-fi white and male, which he says is not true. And he names The Telegraph, Entertainment Weekly, Salon, of course Salon, Huffington Post, /.io9, The Guardian. It was almost like they were all reading of the same script. So here's basically a thing. So on the bottom is the thing that I think was originally said. The Hugo Awards have fallen victim to a campaign in which misogynist groups lobbied to nominate only white males for the science fiction book awards. These groups, Sadpuppies and Rabid Puppies, both of which are affiliated with last year's Gamergate scandal, urged sci-fi fans to become members of the Hugo Awards voting body, World Science Fiction Convention, in order to cast votes against female writers and writers of color. Membership only costs $26 and allows member to vote for the 2016 nominations as well as 2015. So basically, okay, so of course it's reporting the news, but it's Entertainment Weekly, but of course it's so fucking biased and untrue. But it is true that they did ask their fans, if you register, it's only $26, but, you know, we get, like, vote for good stories. They never said, like, oh, fuck those women and those people of color. And of course they posted a correction at the top. They said, correction, after misinterpreting reports and other news publications, EW published an unfair and inaccurate depiction of the Sadpuppies voting slate, which does in fact include many women and writers of color. But of course we didn't bother to check because we're shit at journalism. Oh, wait, they didn't say that. But, you know, it's kind of implied. Because, you know, right. Why would you do journalism?
That's the subtext of this.
When you can copy-paste shit that other people say and assume that they did their research, you don't have to do yours, because that's what journalism is, right?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, I don't know.
Also, Entertainment Weekly, did they hear about the IED that somebody brought to the awards? I believe Brianna Wu was...
Oh, yeah.
Inside information on that IED that Gamergators brought.
Yeah, anyway.
Before any FBI freak out, this is sarcasm.
Yeah, yeah, please, FBI, don't come to my house or kill me or something. As Sadpuppies' Brad Torgensen explained to EW, the slate includes both women and non-Caucasian writer, including Rajnar Vajra. That sounds, you know, I can't blame them because it sounds white as fuck, you know, Rajnar Vajra. I'm like, this is a guy from fucking Mississippi or something. We have Larry Correa, Annie Bellet, which, you know, I guess Larry probably is a guy. Annie, I guess it's sort of a feminine name. Carrie English, again. We have Tony Weisskopf. Again, all names that sound like it's fucking white cis heteroprivileged people. And so words. Megan Gray, Sheila Gilbert, Jennifer Brozek, Cedar Sanderson, and Amon de Green. Again, all people that write good stories that, you know, are like for Sadpuppies and shit. So it's like, oh, whoops, we kind of...
And yet Gamergators are the fucking crazy conspiracy theorists, right? I can already imagine what they were probably saying on Tumblr. Like, oh, look, like, I lost because of Gamergate.
And here's the funny thing. It says, most of them said that last year was a big win for diversity. I believe last year's winner were all white and one Asian. Oops. Oh, whoops. Well, you know, diversity. you know, I said it was either people who wrote love letters to social justice or people that were not white that won, but it seems that it was mostly people who wrote love letters to social justice.
Yeah.
Most of them said our slate was exclusively right-wing, which is not true. In fact, the majority skew left. We have socialists, liberal, moderates, libertarians, conservatives, and question marks. To the best of my knowledge, I believe that last year's diverse winners all espoused the same social justice politics. But there's no bias in this perfectly functioning system. My side said that political narrative trumped reality in this business. Believe me yet. I've seen this behavior before, but never at a level so blatantly false. Truth is utterly irrelevant. Actual positions don't matter, or our actual words are replaced with fabricated new ones in scare quotes, or bizarre out-of-context nonsense. Everyone on my side is held to account in the most outlandish thing anyone tangentially related to us says, even if we're not on our slate. Even if it were not on our slate. But none of the untrue, vile, rude, horrible things said about us by our opposition is ever condemned. Where the fuck have I seen this before, man? It's on the tip of my tongue. I've seen this behavior, but where did it happen?
I think you're thinking of World War II. Like, it was the...
Maybe? I don't know. There was lots of white people there, so probably. I don't know.
Yeah, it was, like, the camps and stuff. I think, like, maybe the Spanish-American War, when like the United States said that Spanish was being sexist with
I don't know. Anyways, let's keep going. We've been yelled at by the Inquisition for failing to notify all of our nominees that we were going to endorse their work, and that makes us bad, not the Inquisition. Don't worry. I don't know. It keeps on going, but and of course I'm gonna add this to the thing you can read. But basically, yeah, it seems like, you know, I don't know, I kind of recognize that behavior. Of course, it's exactly what fucking happened with Gamergate. That was it. I finally remembered it. Anyways.
You solved the puzzle.
I solved the remembering puzzle. anyways, so, and of course, I guess this is kind of like a preview to the anti-gamer section, because Arthur Chu had something to say about one of the people.
Oh, great.
Brad Torgensen.
You know what? I imagine this is going to be incredibly insightful.
Yes, and it's not going to make you pissed off at all. So
I reevaluate my.
So here's what he's shown. There's Clark Hatt that says social justice warriors have accused Brad Torgensen of Sad Puppies of being a racist. Here's Brad with his wife and daughter, which you know is basically black. And then Arthur Chu is like, and here's Brad Torgensen with a shield and another shield.
Oh my God! Yep. Wow, Arthur, you know, I never saw it that way.
I'm secretly a white supremacist, but I'm just going to marry a black person just so nobody will ever know.
Arthur,
hashtag Illuminati.
I'll stop being accused of being an SJW spy if I hook up with another white cis male. I mean female. Beautiful. I did it. Thanks, Arthur. I'm going to go out right now.
So let's keep going. Attention, everyone. Brad Torgensen's wife and daughter are being used as I can be racist human shields in contravention of the rules of war. So it's not just one tweet. He keeps being an idiot over and over again. Here's more. Yes, and I know about John C. Wright's adopted Chinese daughter, too. Thanks, everyone. Gonna keep track. So many shields. You know? And again, I'm sure John was like, you know, I really fucking hate those minorities. But I'm gonna adopt a Chinese daughter.
I gotta keep an eye on them.
I'm gonna keep an eye on that fucking one. You know that fucking. And I'm sure every single dinner he's like, "Hey daughter, do you want to eat rice? Of course you do. You're Chinese. Exactly. Eat that rice, bitch." I don't know. But then it's like, you know. But of course, then you know, on the internet, he's like, "I can't be racist. My daughter is Chinese, and I adopted it." Which of course, you know, it's something really fast that you do by pressing a button. You know, just adopting a Chinese daughter. It's not like a thing that takes multiple months and you have to really think about. And here's more, because, you know, fucking, he never stops.
Oh my God!
I don't know if I have to start at the bottom, but I think I... So is Brad Torgensen a racist? Who the fuck cares? Hashtag Sadpuppies is racist, and his act of supporting it is racist. Of course.
God.
Because...
This sounds like fucking every goddamn religious person I argue with about atheism. It's just like, you know what? Hitler was an atheist, and I'm like, not true, but even if it was, that doesn't mean I'm Hitler, you idiot.
It's like, you know, guilt by association. It's
exactly.
Like,
if you share one common ground with somebody else, you share all of their values.
Arthur Chu is using so much fucking sophistry here, I think we should just rename him Sophie. Sophie Chu. And he says, I don't know or care anything about Torgensen's family. Posting a pic of them to say I can't be racist, racist as fuck. Of course. It's like showing evidence to disprove your fucking argument. Because, you know, if you say this guy's racist, then you're like, well, he married somebody that's not.
Yeah, it's not quite. Like, listen, I see where Arthur was looking at this. Like, oh, I have a black friend, so it's okay for me to say this. Like, you're right. That is
I think marriage is a bigger commitment than friendship.
Adoption.
What do I know? Yeah, adoption. You know, it's just like. Nah, whatever. And you know, it's easier to prove than just having a friend, you know, that I guess you can choose it as an excuse. Anyways, so, and then he goes on saying, no one's dissing Brad's marriage. Hashtag except me, I guess. But you forgot to mention himself. I'm going to keep reading. His marriage is irrelevant to whether his public actions are racist. He's the one trying to connect them. It wasn't. It was somebody else that pointed it on Twitter,
and
I think.
You didn't. Arthur said, two tweets under that, is Brad Torgensen a racist? Who the fuck cares? So he's basically saying, no, he isn't, but he's associated with a group of racists. Therefore, he's a racist. Like, what? Why?
No. And then he is answering some bullshit to people. He says, nobody sure does seem to be bringing them up now for internet points. Yeah, I'm sure Arthur Chu never tweets shit to get internet points. You
Brad
know?
Torgensen has all of the internet points.
You know, like, I think
he's close to winning the game.
Arthur Chu never tweets stuff to gain internet points. Don't look at the three tweets behind that one. It doesn't count. He's not trying to win internet points. But yeah, that's... Man, it's fucking... Arthur is such a fucking moron. I think he's the biggest moron we've ever seen.
He really is, actually. Like, of everyone, yeah, Arthur is kind
of... He could even beat Mercedes.
Oh,
not Mercedes, what am I talking about? Sorry, Macintosh. Yeah, I said Mercedes because I'm basically going to bring a picture of her owning him. That's why
I don't blame you. I think about Mercedes a lot, too.
Yeah, Mercedes. You know, it's so hard because every time... You know, I look at my Twitter feed randomly. Mercedes is like, "Here's a billion pictures of my ass," and I'm like, "Well, it's kind of like
making
my job of finding information
acts.
Harder, but I don't care." You know, Mercedes ass. You know, it's cool.
Yeah.
So Arthur Chu. I don't know. I think it might not be the real Arthur Chu because it's at Mangina Effect.
Maybe not.
I think he was just shooting on Mercedes, and he's like. I don't know. I just want to check real quick. Okay, it is showing on the stream. At least I'm not taking advantage of a bunch of gross dude bros boners. You're an enabler. And she says, what is Arthur Chu for $100? See, you respond with sarcasm. It's all a game to you. What about ZQ, Anita, or B-Woo, who are selfish cunts for $300? Oh my god, yeah, because of course the only achievement Arthur Chu ever accomplished was remembering a bunch of stupid trivia for some show that I don't really care about. But yeah. Alright. That was pretty cool. And of course now we're going to talk about, except if you had anything to add to this
nope.
whole thing. Alright, so we're going to talk about Areyoublocked, and I'm going to bring a picture of Areyoublocked really quickly.
Didn't we play this game last week? Turns out that I was not blocked by these things. That's how you discovered
nope.
that I'm secretly
nope.
an SJW. Oh.
But it's basically a campaign that people started on Twitter basically to increase awareness of those block bots. So they say, like, Christina H. Summers is blocked. You know, she's an author, university professor, scholar. Richard Dawkins is also blocked. Liz Finnegan, the, you know, Lizzie Finnegan at Liz, that we, you know, Lizzie F620 that we talk about a lot. Adam Baldwin, Mark Kern, Mercedes Carrera, Jennifer Daw, and then it's a hashtag Areyoublocked, and then you can, of course, check on Mark Curran's website that he started League for Gamers, and we did that. Of course, we did do that last week, as Beard said.
Right.
But it's good that this campaign is basically trying to start, and then, of course, here's the wall, another picture that they, among many others, it's like blockcheck.leagueofgamers.com to check if you're blocked. Then, of course, there's a great blockbot of social justice, Gawker's Stalker approved. And then, of course, there's the bird going over it and, you know, the guards being like, harassment, misogyny! And it's really great that, you know, people are doing that. That's why I wanted, you know, to talk about it. Because, I mean, I'm sure, you know, on a very visceral level, people would want to know if they're blocked or if they tweeted something that some people don't like. Because it really is censorship. And I'm sure if people realize that they've been blocked for a stupid reason. Oh, by the way, Joe Rogan, the podcaster who does the Joe Rogan Experience, who is also... he talks about, I guess, he comments like MMA fighting or something. He's also blocked. I did tweet at him to bring it to his attention. He hasn't replied. I'm sure he receives tons of shit. But he did talk about Jonathan McIntosh on his show. Like at some point, he referred to, he didn't name him, but he did refer to the tweet where Jonathan McIntosh says, like, you know, when Bin Laden dies, he's like, I would never, you know, be grateful about somebody's death. And then when Christopher Hitchens dies, he's like, I'm glad he's dead. He was a warmonger and a fucking hateful person, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, so again, it's, I guess there's nothing more to talk about it. I guess you can tweet it if you really want to increase awareness. Like people, what people were doing is basically checking if they're on the block bot, and then they said, hashtag are you blocked? And then they said, I was blocked because of these reasons. I did it too. And I said, you know what? It's because I was talking about ethics and following, I guess, the wrong people.
Yep.
Now let's talk, I guess, a little quickly about Lego Dimensions. Basically, there's a polygon. I'm looking for a word to describe him, because I don't want to say journalist. I guess he's a blogger.
Blogger. We'll use blogger.
But I mean, even blogger, it seems like, I know, whatever. It seems nice, but basically, he had insider information about a game that was going to be released called Lego Dimensions. And so he basically registered the domain name legodimensions.com. He said as a joke, of course, when you typed in legodimensions.com on your browser, just in case you wanted to know more about this game, you would be redirected to a Polygon article written by him that talked about the game. And then he said, well, guys, it's just a joke, guys. It was meant to be funny. of course, you know, ignoring, like, the big fucking, you know, the the big ethical breach, I guess I should say, that came with it. Like, you know, if he did that and posted, like, I don't know, like a picture of like a billion dicks or so, like it redirected you to some crazy random website, like maybe I would believe that it was a joke, but it's clearly bullshit. It's probably also illegal. Of course, he did, it cost him $26, and of course now he released it because he was like, oh, it seems that I might maybe get in trouble because of that, but I'm going to make it look like it was my plan all along. Yeah, I'm going to do that. That's basically...
Hey, I'm just trying to figure out why, like, what's funny about that.
No, but I mean, I don't... It's funny. It's funny.
No.
It's just funny. It's like, you thought you were going to have an official website, but in fact, it's a shitty fucking blog website that pretends to talk about video games.
Take that.
And yeah, I guess that's all I had to say about Lego Dimensions. Like, it's the only thing I guess I could ask is, obviously he was wrong. He's an idiot. Let's move on. Of course, other people, like, I forgot what it was his name, but another Polygon writer was just like, I think it was Ben Kuchera who said, like, who just laughed at it. He tweeted at him like, ha 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 ha, as in like, good joke,
course,
buddy.
Yeah. See, the one thing I will say, and full discretion, I actually don't know why the fuck we still talk about Arthur, other than the fact he's a giant idiot. Like, I don't know what he did to gain notoriety, but like Ben Kuchera, I would say, is up there, if only because I'm horrified he has like a semi-professional job and he's a moron. Like,
yeah.
I don't know. Even from not, like, an opinion standpoint, but just from a, like, he writes articles and then says only idiots read gaming articles. It's like, what?
It's, don't ask. It's just that he's, because he operates on a level that's so beyond us that it's
that's
just,
the thing.
Can't,
like,
even understand.
I don't know. People with stupid opinions, I'm like, okay, you have stupid opinions. But people in authority with stupid opinions that just defy explanation really exacerbate me. Like, I just don't know why they are where they're
at. Yeah, but we do talk about Arthur Chu because he's not full Macintosh. He's beyond Macintosh. He's like multi-Macintosh.
I don't know. I'll never forget when Macintosh was just like, oh, I've been pretending to be an idiot for 4 years.
Okay,
like,
yeah,
that was a lot of fun.
It's like the oldest trick on the internet. I was only pretending to be an idiot, guys. I got you, and therefore, it is you who are the idiots, not I.
That was still one of my favorites. Like, I'll never forget that.
People used to do that on fucking 4chan, a board that's anonymous. Yeah, yeah. It's like, you could just not say anything and nobody would know, but I guess you had to. Your ego's just that big, buddy.
Yeah.
Anyways, so I guess let's move on talking about Ken Levine, which is the developer for, he worked on BioShock. I don't know if I think he did the first BioShock, and of course all the other BioShocks. I'm sure he did 2 and 3, but I think he did 1, 2, you know, whatever, BioShock. 3, of course, which is Infinite, which is shit, but, you know, doesn't matter. Basically, on an interview for Game Informer, he said that what's important when you create a character is not what's their identity or, like, what's their skin color or if they're gay or Jewish or whatever. It's, like, what is the character? It's basically, like, when you make a character, you shouldn't ask yourself, like, you shouldn't define him as a black person. You should actually ask questions like, what is this person? Like, what is this goal? What's preventing that character from achieving his goals? To basically weave a good story. And, of course, it's something that, you know, I think a lot about when I you know, think about stories for comic books or when I try to be a dungeon master for Dungeons & Dragons. I'm sure Beard does that all the time and better than me because he's a better DM.
Well, and again, actually, if I can just jump in really quickly, and I think that that's shown really well, and I wish I could remember what that site was. You brought it up. You play a short little Legend of Zelda game where Link's a giant misogynist, giant air quotes.
You mean the real Legend of Zelda game?
The real Legend of Zelda.
No, yeah. Okay. No, we're talking about a parody, yeah, but... I don't know, I guess I will read a bit of an... I don't know if I should read a bit of an article, actually, but either way, I'm just going to check really quickly if I had a picture for it. No. I guess I'll bring it on the screen really quickly and maybe find a meaningful paragraph or something. Just screen shared. I guess you can talk about what you were going to say, Beard.
Oh, no, so that's basically it, is that they do, like, for a lot of these characters, people do seem to sort of just bring up, and even Anita Sarkeesian, we saw last week with that fucking, shit, I know that she complimented a lot. It was just like, this character is just a girl, and that's all you know about them, and so it's just like, this is a wonderful character, because their only character trait is that they have breasts. It's like, great, awesome, good writing.
Yeah, I think it's basically like a piece about the writer saying like that he's Jewish, he's being raised Jewish, and that's why he kind of wanted to write this type of articles, because there's lots of Jewish characters in BioShock, and I assume it's because of the setting, you know, that it's the case.
Yeah.
But basically, yeah, that's when he said like, oh, he explains basically, you know, like he explains a bit. I mean the. About his characters, like, he's, I'm just going to read this paragraph as an example. It was less about faith and more about what their Jewishness meant to others, Levine told me in a pre-interview message exchange. Ryan's bourgeois family was ruined by the Bolsheviks, Tenenbaum's family was slaughtered by the Nazis, Cohen and Steinman were cultural American Jews, but in that time others defined them by their Jewishness. Or something. And again, I have no fucking context, but for most of the article, basically, he talks about it's just, like, incidental. Like, what's important is their, you know, their goals and, you know, what makes them actual fucking people, you know? And, of course, it's all you should focus on, I think, to make a good character, because if you focus on a person's blackness, what you're going to have in the end is just a fucking token character. And it's,
right.
It's
and now, with... Sometimes these things can play into their characters, but they shouldn't be the cornerstone of who they are. And in fact, one that did piss off a lot of people, that little girl character from The Last of Us, and again, for those of you that haven't watched our earlier podcast to sort of save you time, there was a DLC that was released that the little girl turned out to be a lesbian. It wasn't a fundamental part of who she was. In fact, the entire first game it sort of wasn't touched on, and then during the DLC it was just sort of like a final, like,
yeah,
and
by the way, she's a lesbian.
Yeah, and a lot of people freaked out, but I actually didn't think it was that big of a deal, and I think that sometimes your race or sexuality, again, here's my everyone's going to jump on me for being a secret gamer gator.
Wait, Beard. Get ready, everyone. To your keyboards, get ready to leave a comment. How Beard's an idiot.
Beard versus Beard.
Get fucking ready.
These things can... Well, and I think that that was just parroted by... who wrote that article? The person who wrote the BioShock thing. Is they can play into a portion of their character, but it's not a character trait.
Yeah,
it's just... part of who they are. Like, it can play into the way that they look at things, particularly if their race or sexual identity has a part in the narrative, but may have impacted them somehow. But I don't know. If you make a black person say, oh, hell nah, because they're the black person, like, that I think should get...
Let me add to what Beard's saying, just really quickly. Like, let's say you create a character that he is of a certain race, and he lives in a society that hates the race he is, and he suffers from lots of racism for some reason. And it causes this character basically to grow to hate the race of the people that in the society he was raised in, which kind of, like, I don't know, it creates an interesting, you know, you kind of understand why this character is acting like this, but it doesn't mean that this character is right because he suffered racism. Let's say if in the, you know, in the game, like, he wants to kill them or, you know, right. I guess get back at them. And of course he could act differently, but it's, you know, it's how, I guess, a character's race could influence who they are. But, of course, the fact that a character's, you know, was targeted by racism doesn't mean, like, oh, now he's in the right because he was a victim in the past or something.
Right.
Yep. Did I? No,
that's it. No, I would have jumped in, but you basically said what I was going to say.
Oh, see? I'm doing Beard better than him. Send me hate messages, folks.
I just didn't want to start rambling.
Yeah.
That's it. So... I imagine that he got flack for this completely reasonable statement.
Yeah, people said he was, like, I guess, I don't know, like, I don't have any specific comments, I'll be honest.
Oh,
like,
okay.
I didn't manage to find any. Not I guess you were expecting them, guys, but I don't know. We have tons, don't worry. But basically, like, I did hear people mention that people said he was racist because of that, because, of course, like, how dare you not put the limelight on a character's race? That's totally that's totally racist. Fucking double think again.
Wow.
So, let's go look at, we're now at Shit NT Gamers Say. Let's take a look at those juicy, juicy little comments. I can't wait.
Are you guys excited too?
Okay, so we have Aaron Diaz, which I nicknamed the Comic Book Dictator. So here's what he says. Dear sexy cheesecake superhero artists, that's 100% fine, but comics aren't all about you anymore. You need to understand context and tone. Equating don't do that here with you cannot do that anywhere is the embodiment of privilege. Remember that. Why don't you make your own characters / games / movies is privileged, thuggish, anti-intellectual dismissal, and always has been.
What? Why?
I have no idea. But basically what he's saying...
Are you saying, like, Cosmopolitan is anti-intellectual because they don't write articles directed towards men?
Yeah, they should... You know, Cosmopolitan should write more articles about guns and beer.
Like,
and,
what?
And NASCAR. Which are not necessarily things I like. I'm just trying, you know, to be stereotypical.
Yeah, I don't know.
But what he's saying is that you have to understand that comics aren't all about you anymore. Therefore, you can't write these things in comic books because this bullshit I came up with. Like, you're saying, like, you can write about it, just not in the comic book industry because it's not about that anymore. Of course, what makes it about that is...
Oh, my God.
I don't know what it is. I guess it's...
You know that really famous character, Daredevil? That one that's just a white male that has nothing different about him? Oh, wait, he's disabled! Like, oh my God.
He's blind, but he's magic blind. All his other senses are better or something.
Well, so no, but that's what I'm saying. It's just like people are just like, yeah, because all of the superheroes were white heterosexual males. Yeah, you know?
I just thought of the funniest thing. You know, all the superheroes, like Spider-Man's superpower is he sticks on walls and he jumps really high. Daredevil's power is he's blind.
He's super blind.
I can't wait for... The super, like, some dude that's a superhero that's, like, just, like, stuck in a wheelchair, and that's the only superpower they have. Oh, wait, Oracle, we talked about it.
Yeah. See, I don't mean to detract too much, but just to throw it out there, and Daredevil isn't even that super blind because there's that kid. I thought it was bullshit. I'm still sort of leery about it. It does sound fake to me, but regardless, there's that YouTube video of that blind kid who can use echolocation. He just, like, clicks when he's riding a skateboard and he can hear things. Yeah. I kind of think it's bullshit, but I've been told by a few people that it's real. But that guy would kick the shit out of Daredevil.
Speaking of that, did you... I don't know, in some occasions, it seems Daredevil has, like, really super hearing and shit, but, like,
yeah, especially in the rain thing. Yeah, every time it rains, he's like, I can see better than everyone else.
Wasn't that in the movie? But, on Netflix, there's a new series. Did you watch it at all?
No, I didn't.
Yeah, I didn't either, but I plan to, so I guess there's going to be a review of that at some point. Because everybody's like, it's amazing! So, yeah, I guess it got my attention. Anyway, so let's go back to shit NT gamers say and go with this girl called Archivist Geek, who is trying to... I forgot what this guy's name was, you know, but the guy that said like that all gamer gators should be like stuck in Nazi ovens. She's I don't know if she succeeds, but she's definitely trying to beat him at his own game. So she says, ban gamer gators and MRAs from conferences, games to studies programs, conventions, social media, wipe them out, all of them. It seems reasonable. Of course, it has one whole retweet. and of course, she says, my only regret in all of this is treating anyone from Gamergate as human.
Open discourse.
She's looking at herself in the mirror and just being like, you know, I really... If I have one regret, it's showing empathy to my fellow human beings. I should just fucking crush them because, I mean, they're hateful people who don't consider other people as human beings. So
their
ideas
should never be considered. Yeah.
So there were more, but you know, I think.
Which is actually something later on, and I'm sort of just bringing this up because I'll probably forget if I don't bring it up now, is talking about that sort of idea, like whether or not toxic ideas should be spread or not. But not saying that it is. I just. Again, we know an individual who is opposed to the idea of things that we disagree with and whether or not spreading toxic ideas actually reinforces them, whereas I believe that both of us disagree. Hmm.
Let's talk about Randy Harper, the girl who made the GG Autoblocker program, who is, by the way, fat as fuck, if you didn't know.
Wow. This is the sort of thing that Red Knight's trying to make us not.
Yeah, I know. But the reason... Well, look at her fucking avatar. Look at it.
So?
Look at how fucking slim she... Because, you know... And I don't even care if she's fat. The reason why I brought it up is just because she's the kind of person to kind of say that if you say that, it's kind of like... She hates people who are quote-unquote fat-shaming and claims that being fat is not a negative trait, yet in all... And she has a new fucking avatar, and again, she looks slim in it, and she says she tries to pretend that being fat is not, like, a negative thing and say that it's not, but, I guess she kind of knows because all of her fucking profile pictures are her being slim.
This is a bigger social issue. I don't know. Okay. I mean, you can pick on whoever you want for whatever you want. I'm just saying
again,
that I personally don't share that.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I don't even fucking care, honestly. Like, if you're fat or whatever, like, I don't give a shit. But it's just I do care when people are hypocrites. That's the only thing. but it's not what is important here. What is really important is that she's going to create another block bot, or she says she will. Basically, she tweets, by request, I'll be creating another shared block list with everyone that used the Areyoublocked hashtag today. You're welcome. And this is why I named this picture Blockception, because it's like, hey, if you want to know if you're blocked, yes it is. And I made a new block bot to make sure of that.
We heard you like blocking, so now you can block what you block.
Yeah. All those let's say more memes. Anyways, New Space Dad says, there's a few non-gators posting the tag ironically. Gonna use some kind of whitelist method for them?
No.
I don't care. Oh.
It's using search API at the end of day. If people really don't like it, they can delete their tweets.
Wow.
I'm too lazy to program something
Let's
good.
Sterilize the internet.
Yes. So, well, I don't know. I guess if she really does sterilize it, nobody will ever tell her that she's fat again. And again, I don't care, but it's just, you know, she's fat. No. I'll stop being mean now.
I can't wait until someone's just like, man, I really hate this thing. Hashtag in my blog.
We all know that exercise is a tool of the patriarchy and that ice cream stands for women's empowerment. Anyways.
My God.
Okay, now I'm going to stop trying to be as offensive as possible now and go on to...
and I get the hate!
Yeah, well, I don't know. I'm trying to get more. Because I've been feeling left out, you know? Speaking of crazy people, we have Brianna that started... It's almost like old lady yells at cloud at this point. but...
Maddox yells at Vine users. Sorry.
So here's what she fucking tweeted recently, and it's just... I was sent screenshots this weekend of gamer gators planning to kidnap my dogs. This is not just criminal. Oh. It's deranged.
Gamer Gate's trying to steal my dogs! Pay attention to me, please!
What the fuck?
I'm sure Gamer Gators are like, you know what's going to bring ethics in games journalism?
Yeah, I feel so bad for bringing dogs. Like, oh my god. Man.
Hashtag Gamer Dog Thieves.
Give me back my mighty machines or whatever.
Oh, yeah, hashtag give me back my macro machines. By the way, it has not trended since last week, and I'm very disappointed in all of you viewers.
Yeah.
No, I don't care, actually. But
yeah. Anyways. Man, I can't believe that she actually thinks it's like, what?
So here's some comment by Emma Clarkson, you know, talking about Brianna Wu. Who is Emma Clarkson? She's basically somebody that worked for Brianna Wu's company. And now that she's not working for her anymore, she has a few things to say about Brianna. So she says, today I have joined an exclusive club of women game developers, both supported and blocked by Brianna Wu. Good thing Brie and I aren't working on BFIG together this year again, so I won't have to do all the work she decides not to do this time around.
Oh.
If Brianna Wu ever hires you to do work and you quit the contract because it's going past the agreed date, watch out, she lied that she fired you. I also wouldn't recommend appointing Brianna Wu to manage anything that requires any actual work on her behalf if you expect it to get done. If you want someone who will say the same stuff about Gamergate over and over again at your college or university, then get in touch, I guess.
Yeah.
And then Pixel Metal says, I was in the booth directly next to Rev 60 at 2014 BFIG. I don't remember seeing anyone other than Frank there, which is Brianna's husband, I guess. And she says, that's because Brianna was off doing important interviews and terrorizing our volunteers who were attempting to do their jobs. So she obviously has no words of love for Brianna Wu, and I think it's kind of funny. And of course, there's no way to verify if it's true or not, because it's just her word against, I guess, Brianna Wu's word, but I don't know.
Still funny.
Yeah. anyways, so here's another article that talks a little bit about Gone Home, and the reason why I'm talking about it, well, at least it's just a tweet by Anastasia Salter, and basically it's because now Gone Home is not progressive enough. It's just not good enough.
So wait,
she
what?
Says, no, here's what she says. She says, I don't know exactly where I'm supposed to go, but Gregory Bagnell talking about Gun Home plus tendency of games to present queer characters rather than queer game design structures. What the fuck is queer game design structure? I have no idea.
What?
Bagnell pointing out that Gun Home seems to represent queer youth through reductivist and negative lens, a very common narrative. So she's saying that basically Gun Home is not progressive enough. A game that was all about being progressive is just not progressive enough anymore.
Well, see, and I was fucking waiting for it, because again, with all of this where someone thinks that if you state an idea, you endorse the idea, which we were just talking about earlier, yeah. I was expecting lots of people, again, with what they were getting pissed off about Pillars of Eternity or whatever, for making a comment about something. Like, again, it Gone Home, it's like, oh, this character who's dealing with being a lesbian was, like, ridiculed for being a lesbian, therefore it hates lesbians. It's like, wow, well, you... Wow. Like, I don't know what to tell you.
Before we continue, I just have a quick comment by Isaac Kurth, who left a comment, I guess, a few minutes ago or something. He said, since actual board games can be quite the investment, ever think to use something like Tabletop Simulator for them? It'll allow remote play with friends and already has a ton of popular games for downloads as mods, and you're looking at only $15 versus $150. Total Biscuit has been giving it a good bit of attention in his Lounge series.
Sorry, who sent that comment?
Isaac Kurtz.
Isaac Kurtz, regular watcher, thank you, man. And actually, it's really funny you say that, because I was just, honest to goodness, I was about to bring that up.
We both own the game, and we've played it.
Yeah. As soon as I saw it, I was like, we need this. We played a thing on it. You know what? We should do that, man.
We definitely should. Let's do that.
I did notice that there were some problems with it, because it is... not only does it deal with some copyright issues, like I noticed that they were fighting over Munchkin a little bit, but it also has some issues loading some stuff. Since I've played it since the last time Matt and I played House on the Hill, Betrayal on House of the Hill, was a really long time ago. But actually, I do really like that idea. Well, if we could only find like one or two more people to play with us, but I mean, otherwise, we should honestly give it a whirl.
You know what, viewers? If you want to play board games with us, just send us a message.
Yeah. I mean, like, both Matt and myself also have stuff that we do after work, which is sort of why we get bogged down. Like, I'm trying to bang through other games that we can talk about them. But, this is turning into an excuse, and it shouldn't be. You're definitely right.
All right.
Thanks, Isaac.
Let's keep going. Where was I? Oh, yeah, we have a comment, I think, by Izzy. And it's not that relevant to anything, but Izzy has been basically just a person, as far as I'm aware, that's been talking a lot against Gamergate. And recently, I think they got into trouble because of something that happened in their life or something. And then Gamergate was trying to be nice and send him positive messages. And he replied, to the Gamergaters trying to show me support for speaking out, you can fuck off. If you truly cared, you'd leave your hate group. It's like, I know you're trying to send me, good vibes, but it doesn't count because you're in a group that is a hate group that only sends hate and never good things.
It's like we described before. If someone came and was just like, hey, can you donate money to this cause that has nothing to do with our ideologies? And they're like, do you think that women are objectified in video games? And they're like, well, no, not really. And then they just slam the door in their face. Like,
here's a comment by Beardy Blue. Or Ben, which was, I guess, retweeted by Randy Harper. And it's special. So here's, he says, watching Mark Kern melt down when a woman don't do what he wants would be almost funny if it wasn't so creepy. And of course, and then he shows posts of Mark Kern saying, hi, Cameron, you have a quote from me in your article that implies I am Gamergate or Sadpuppies. I am neither, please correct. I think you did some great editing, but I disagree about your fact-checking. Please DM me for a correction. I can see you are online and you don't block me. I would really appreciate a response. Thank you. I can see Cameron Hurley online and retweeting. I have reached out to her and at the Atlantic and the IIC. No response. So it seems like Mark Kern is trying to have people correct things on him, which seems to be inaccurate, and Ben is like, oh man, that fucking Mark Kern is melting down on Twitter and against a woman above all things. What a creepy bastard. And it's like, it's almost as if he's forgetting we can read the fucking post you tweeted under it.
Yeah. You know? I mean, he does kind of have a point. Like, well, actually, because I can't quite see the times that he posted these things or anything, like, if they're all within...
I know that one is at 5:02 p.m. and the other one is at 5:47.
But they're all within like the same day.
No, one is on. Yeah, I think. I think at least I can see two are on the same day.
I definitely think meltdown is an extremely heavy term.
But I mean, because I mean, it's on Twitter, so sometimes some people have lots of messages and they won't necessarily see all of them. Maybe
Fair enough. No, you're right. Though I mean,
I think it's unfair because he's just honestly put yourself in the place of Mark Kern. There's basically people saying bullshit on them on articles, and he's just like, hey, can I just, you know, at least share my point of view or say it's not accurate or something.
You know what? And actually, I retract that statement, my own, because as someone that doesn't use Twitter that often, because shit moves fast, I actually sort of retract
what I said. Like, you do get notifications when people tweet at you, but I guess, and I don't know how popular that person is, but sometimes
you're definitely right. Mark wasn't freaking out. He was just trying to do his due diligence, because it would have spread really, really quickly if people weren't like...
And surprisingly,
Animals, dogs.
We talked a little bit about Peter Coffin, who had many words against Gamergate, but now he recently basically talked to Jonathan McIntosh, and surprisingly, he was the voice of reason in that debate. Of course, people will say, well, it's against Jonathan McIntosh, it's not really a big achievement, but you know, for Peter Coffin, I guess it kind of is. So here's the exchange. Jonathan McIntosh says, come on, gamers, you deserve better than the same exact boring, hyper-masculine, badass, cyberpunk, Jesus cliche characters year after year.
Can I just stop you there? I'd like to just point out, I like that he ended it with Jesus. Like, what? Like, I don't...
Jesus as in, this character is like a savior here to save humanity or something, I guess. And then Peter Coffin is like, come on, Radical Bites, let's not tell people what they're allowed to like. And I'm like, wow, I totally agree with that statement, Peter. That's fucking amazing.
Yeah.
And then he says, cultural criticism isn't about personal preferences. It's about deconstructing meaning and harmful values embedded in media. Of course, nobody's saying that games make you racist. You know, except kind of like...
Yeah.
Gosh. And then Peter Coffin says, you're making it about personal preference here. And it's, again, oh, well... Yeah. That's surprising. Yeah. That's great.
He
didn't
even use the word like misogyny or racist or sexist. He just said cyberpunk super Jesus or something. It's like, well,
that's good for him. You know, I have another little comment here from Randy Harper, who, you know, is pretty and all, and I like her. Okay. but basically, you know, she's just, I don't know, I was trying to make a joke.
I don't care. I don't know her. I'm just saying.
Well, I don't know. If you notice, like, never before I have even mentioned it. It's just today that I'm like...
Yeah, have you mentioned her weight or the fact that these girls have dyed hair.
No, but her specifically. You know, I almost feel like Austin Powers in the second movie, where he's like, "Bone." Okay, maybe not quite, but whatever. Judge me if you want, internet. But you don't know my true feelings.
They won't. They'll come to me and be like, "How dare you?
What did you allow him on the podcast, Beard? It's your fault." So she says, Gamergate's new harassment hashtag has less than 6,000 tweets. They planned on getting it trending. Gamergate is shrinking, y'all. And then, of course, Areyoublocked is at 30,000 tweets. And Gamergate is at, like, you know, of course, really fucking high. So again, it seems that she's not paying attention to numbers or anything. Like, it did trend. Like, Areyoublocked trended like fucking crazy. It's amazing how Gamergate can make shit trend, like, without any effort. And finally we have, I guess, just a funny tweet about Team Meat getting trolled by the best gamers, who always tweet funny shit on Twitter. And what's really funny is they got blocked for it, but,
yeah.
So basically, because, again, people are voting for, like, what character would you want in Super Smash Brothers, people made a mock-up of Super Meat Boy in it, and then they said, this would be pretty amazing, make it happen, go vote. And then the best gamer says, I mean, it makes sense because there's so many possibilities for his moves, like dying or clipping through the floor and dying.
Yeah, you brought this one in.
No, I have shown it just to you.
Right. Yeah, no, you're right.
Yeah. So of course, they got blocked for it.
Yeah, that was a little silly.
Which is
even Escapist ran an article and said that it was actually doing really well.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy. All right, now we are at the segment of the show where we talk about video game news, because, yeah, it's fun. So basically, I guess it's going to be quick. Trine 3 has been announced. It's a game series I really like. Trine 1 and 2, you know, great graphics, amazing music. Trine 3 basically was announced. They've shown gameplay, you know, as opposed to all those trailers who don't show any. And basically now, it's in full 3D. It's not just 2.5D where you just can go back and forth. You can go in full 3D. And what's really good is, like, the preview kind of starts as in, like, they just move. Like, there's a thing in the background, and they move, like, from left to right. And then at some point, boom, it just goes in the background and starts smashing shit. And it's like, surprise, motherfucker. Full, you know, they just show it. And I think it's a great trailer for that. In other news, you know, and again, of course, I'm sure it's going to be a great game. Five Nights at Freddy's is going to get a movie. And lots of people were fucking going crazy about it, because it's like, oh, it's just fucking hipster overhyped game garbage getting a movie. Why? I don't know. I guess I think it's a good premise for a movie.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I'm not part of that camp either. Like, I'm not going to
freak before. Out. Like, it's been done before. Sure, it's probably been done before. It's probably just cashing in on Five Nights at Freddy's. But, I mean, we're going to have a horror movie about animatronic scaling people, which is basically like every horror movie ever, just with a touch of Five Nights at Freddy's. I don't know.
I don't know. Am I the only one who's followed this trend of video games never translating into film well, if it gets made at all? Like, when I read that, I did read it on The Escapist, like, I would have brought it in if I thought it was valid at all, but I didn't, because I immediately looked at it and was like, oh yeah, Dead Island's supposed to have a movie.
I don't know. Well, to be fair, like, they have a lot to work with, so maybe it's going to be good. It might probably be shit. Who knows? But, you know, I mean, I'm saying is, like, don't fucking condemn it before. Like, I don't know. I've seen some people, of course, they were being ironic, but it's like, I want this world to end. Why?
It's just but it's the internet's job to be fucking oversensitive to everything that happens. Again, let's quote everyone who's been like, Beard is a SJW spy.
But you are. I don't see what...
Definitely. No, I mean, it has an interesting lore, but I almost feel like it would be like writing a sequel to Majora's Mask. I mean, though, when you say the idea, there's tons of people that would be like, fuck yeah, but the whole reason that it's intriguing is because it's mysterious. You don't want these things explained.
So, the... okay, yeah. I guess in other video game news, Afterlife Empire, which is a game that was funded through the Fun Young Capitalist, Gamergate helped a lot, and basically now they are on Greenlight, and of course you can vote if you would probably play the game. It seems kind of like a mix of... what's the word? Basically like a tycoon game and that fucking game where you're... defend a dungeon, kind of. Like, basically, you're in a ghost house and you're trying to scare people. And, of course, in the trailer...
Dungeon Keeper?
Yeah, Dungeon Keeper. That's it. Basically, they show in the trailer, like, really quickly, Vivian James in Gamergate, because she's going to be in the game. So it's really cool. I think lots of people are liking it. If you think it's a great game, sure, give it a little thumbs up or something. Just like this video. If you like it, give it a thumbs up, bitches. And, yeah, okay, so that's... That's enough subliminal messages for today. We do have... another thing quickly. There's this protagonist from a Final Fantasy game who was dressed really scantily clad. Here's what he looks like. I mean, it's sluttier than most female characters. Yeah. And I guess people got upset and were like, it has to be changed. And now people tried to, I guess, start a trend about changing him back to this outfit. Which, what? Honestly, I don't know. Like, I guess for equality or something. Because, again, it's just changing people's art. And, of course, this... outfit is fucking ridiculous. Like, I won't lie about it.
It's almost reverse. Like, I can remember reading, talking in my law class in my hometown. Basically, there was a law passed that, like, again, a bunch of feminists got together. This was a long time ago, but a bunch of, like, feminists got together and were like, we also want to be able to walk around without our shirts on. And it passed, and they can, and nobody does it. This is almost the reverse. Like, men shouldn't be able to do not wear shirts, so let's pass a law that everyone has to wear shirts. It's like, well, guys, like, come on now.
No, but I guess it's kind of... I don't know. I don't know exactly what it means, the fact that some people were pissed at it because it's a man or something. Whatever. I think it should be allowed like everything else.
I
think it's stupid.
Let's be outraged about, you know...
I don't know. Buildings
are phallical-shaped. We should have, like, giant caverns in the ground to represent the vaginal canal as buildings, because buildings are too sexist.
And yeah.
Of course, I have to sound more outraged.
Let's try this. Anyway. All right, so, and finally, we have a cool thing about Pokemon Shuffle, which I did give a review. It's, for people who don't know... basically, it's a game that it's Nintendo trying to do an Apple type game, you know, where you spend money. And here's the cool thing that they did. I'm not even gonna bring it up on the screen. I'm just gonna read it. It says about the game. The unique bit is that once you purchase 3,000 gems, which is just under $30 if you buy large packs of gems, 41 if you buy the smallest pack 50 times, you're barred from spending any more money at all. In addition to the 3,000 gems you bought, you from then on receive a drip of 20 gems per day, and the stage refresh and roulette bypass purchases are discounted. The net effect is that you can essentially play as much as you want, however you want. Which means that once you spend a decent amount of money, it's like you bought the game and you can play the game normally. And it's basically a thing Nintendo did without being asked for, that people asked other companies to do it on the App Store, that they don't do because it's like, excuse me, I can't hear you, I'm swimming in money. So yeah. I think it's a cool thing Nintendo has done. I don't know if they're going to change it, but you know, it shows that, I guess, sort of, somewhere they're good people at heart. I guess.
Well, it's tricky. This whole thing... I mean, I definitely see what you're saying. I totally support, like, what... So, exactly how much, then, would the price tag of Pokemon Shuffle be, then, if you were to buy... So, under $30, how much are you spending to play this game like a normal video game?
$30, so...
Okay. Would you say it's worth that?
Probably not, because it's a free game, but I mean... I mean, it's still fair. Like, you play, even if it's not technically... Well, it's still a very fun game. Don't get me wrong. I still play it, you know, just, like, randomly. But it's... I don't know, like you pay the game, you pay cheaper than you would pay for a normal game, because most games that Nintendo actually release, you play, you know, it's $59, so it's like almost half price of a regular game.
Right.
And it's still too much for it, but I mean, it's still, you know, it's still very nice. I mean, it's decent, like it's not ridiculous, like I can't really play for it. I guess a quick comment by Mighty Sky Wizard that just popped up on my screen. Five Nights at Freddy's as a film, video game made into a good movie. I would be impressed if they achieve where others have failed hard. The game you may have been thinking about is Ghostmaster, where you scare peeps away and find ghosts. It wasn't that. It was Dungeon Keeper. But there is a game on the Sega Genesis where you're just a ghost and you kind of like jump into furniture to scare people. And I thought this game was going to be like that, but I think it's not quite that.
Right.
But yeah, so maybe that's what Ghostmaster is. I don't remember. It was a Genesis game that I used to rent when I was a kid, and I really loved it, even though it was kind of shit now that I think back about it. You know, because every time you would kind of like die, you'd go in this stupid underlevel where like tons of shit was flying at you, and I didn't understand what was going on. But then if you, I guess, pass that level, you go back in the house, and it's kind of like a continue, but like to continue the game, you have to go through bullshit or something. I don't know. Still, it was fun because, you know, you could go in a flower pot and shoot shit at people and they would get scared. You could go in like the sofa and then it would become a monster and shit. That was cool. It was interesting. It was different.
Sorry, to bring it back to the topic really quickly, like the Pokemon show, thing.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, I didn't know you were. You wanted to say more.
No, just a quick thing. Like, in regards to what you were saying, like, that's good that they did that. I noticed that a lot of people, and even us, like, complain about games doing, like, pre-purchases and post-purchases and stuff. I think that it's really important, at least in my opinion, to stress that it is the consumer's responsibility if they want these practices to stop, because you can't blame game companies for wanting to make money. Right, like these microtransactions, they, like, you can't expect a company to handicap itself, right? And actually, there's a great, you know, regardless how you feel about him, I wish I could recite exactly what he said and like what show it was, but Jim Sterling actually talked about video game companies potentially lowering down below that $70 mark, you know, where one comes out at launch as $40 or $30, I think would benefit the company a lot. But again, it's, to me, you can't blame, and I don't fucking know mobile games, if Flappy Bird's like buying a gem is like a dollar.
Flappy Bird is, as far as I'm aware, is just a dollar, and you can play it forever.
Regardless, microtransactions, whatever. Like that new game that came out on PS4 where you can buy a car for like $100 or whatever. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, it's stupid, and like it's totally okay to mock stupid business practices. But
like, for example,
if people are buying it, fuck.
Selling your complete game for $100.
Yeah. Exactly. Right. And again, but. And I mean,
again, that nobody's playing anymore, you know?
With this being said, yeah, totally. It's Titanfall Syndrome all over again. But with this being said, I'm not coming out like this is me. I'm recognizing this is me standing on a soapbox again. It does frustrate me. But again, it's our responsibilities to stop. I mean, recently, and I fucked up too, right? Like, I bought a season pass to Dark Souls 2, and I don't even particularly like that game. That was a poor decision. Like, I am just as culpable and just as responsible for changing the industry as
I did worse. I bought Borderlands.
I know. Sorry, how much money have you spent on Dota so far?
Oh, dude, I don't even want to think about it, dude. They should allow me to play the game for free. Oh, wait.
It's well over.
It is already free all the time. You don't have to spend any money. Oh, well.
Well over triple digits. But again, but with that being said, I can laud Dota for its business practices because then somebody like myself who has spent probably
$10?
I don't know. Well, I bought a compendium.
Which was $10?
Like, I'm probably, if I had to guess, like $30, and the better majority of them were like gifts and stuff. And I think that's highballing. That's still half the price of a new.
It's crazy because I have a friend who actually gave me a birthday gift that was a Dota item. it was a customized courier, and I was like, oh man, that's nice. He called it I forgot.
Matt's,
I forgot the name.
Matt's waifu.
Yeah, what's my but it's the fucking protagonist from what's that fucking manga cartoon where the main character is a girl that's socially awkward or something. I forgot. Yeah. And it has a ridiculous long Japanese name. But basically, it's her name. And it's only because I was like, man, I kept telling him about the comic and being like, that fucking girl is so, like, fucking weird. I hate her. And then he's like, he's like, here, you, obviously she's your wife. Will you talk about her all the time? But enough about
Anyways, let's move on.
You know, I love talking about my life and how I'm the best person, but it's time to talk. I guess we will talk a little bit about not quite Dungeons & Dragons, but Pathfinder, which is basically Dungeons & Dragons. And, you know, tell us if you like this segment, because we're going to talk a little bit. We're going to tell a story, basically, of what happened in our game of Dungeons & Dragons last week, because it's and tell us if you enjoy this good old little story time, or if you don't, I guess we'll just not have this segment anymore. So basically, first I guess we'll talk about our characters and what we wanted to do, just as I guess as an introduction. We made basically a game that is set in the Underdark, which is, I guess, a special setting in some of, I guess, D&D campaigns, which is basically under the ground, and there's, you know, drow or dark elves fighting with, like, all kinds of creatures, like, you know, goblins and all. So basically there's no, like, elves or humans, because they're on the surface and shit. I was making a pause if you wanted to say anything, but basically, and we made a few characters. Like for me, for example, I'm going to be playing Grimmel, which is a sorcerer, which is kind of like a wizard, except he hasn't learned his magic. Basically, it's just like he casts spells naturally, and basically
it's innate through some point in his bloodline or some sort of exposure.
Yeah, basically, an ancient magical creature like fucked one of your ancestors, and now you kind of have magic that's related to that. And basically, his bloodline is Draconic. So basically, he's a little goblin that thinks he's a dragon, but he's clearly just a stupid goblin. But then he's like, hello, my name is Grimmel. I am a dragon. What is your name? And he just goes around and putting himself in all sorts of trouble.
As you viewers can already tell, Matt practiced for a really long time for his Grimmel voice. He's
Yes, indeed I did. Don't judge me.
Yeah. So if you find this annoying, well, sit with it for 5 hours and then tell me.
It's a great voice. Fuck you.
We all have voices, so I can't throw stones.
Yeah. So why don't you tell us about your character beer that you made?
Sure. So in the Underdark again, it's largely monstrous races. I'm playing a bugbear brawler, which is a hybrid class from Pathfinder. It is the combination of a monk and a fighter class together. They sort of like blend their class features to those of you more familiar with Dungeons & Dragons.
It's basically a monk without the key bullshit. It's just like, I punch people in the face.
I get lots of feats, but they can like be changed around and stuff.
That's versatile.
Bugbear...
You were going to say it. Say what a bugbear is.
Yeah, so a bugbear is basically like a giant goblin.
That is also a bear.
Yeah, basically. His name is Kumat. He also has a voice.
Do the Kumat voice.
I don't know, man.
Do it. Come on, viewers. Tell me to do it.
So I talk like this. And when I talk in goblin, I have like a weird British accent.
And now everyone's going to be pissed off. But anyway, so, yeah, we're enormous nerds, and, yeah.
It's fun. And
I also wonder how I got laid. But, so...
I got laid many times. I don't know what you're talking about.
It's interesting for my character anyways, and I haven't thought a lot about it, honestly, but my sort of take of Kumat is that he is the equivalent of basically like a beast of burden. As sort of like part of our role playing, I talked to another person that we're gaming with who is playing a drow sorceress and basically was like, can my character be your character's pet? So we have a unique relationship in that basically my bugbear just walks around and
does whatever his mistress says.
And so basically, and I guess we could almost segue into the character of that friend, which is called Veritasia Bloodborne or something, or Veri. Yep. She's basically a drow sorceress that has her bloodline is actually serpentine, so she's basically almost like a snake, like she can grow snake fangs, as opposed to Grimmel, who can grow claws and shit. And at a later level, will become a dragon. But enough about my character. Let's talk more about Veritasia. So basically, he wants to focus on basically an evil person that can almost mind control other people and make them do her bidding. And she's supposed to be like this really pompous, really like full of herself, because she's basically the daughter of a noble house of Drow, and she basically left her home because she was going to be married by her mother or something, so now she treats basically everybody else like shit.
yeah.
And it's kind of funny, because like in our past campaign, one of the people who played, you know, played a sorceress she would do two things. She would throw fire spells and mind control other people. So it's almost as if her character kind of split into both our characters. But the reason, I created Grimmel is because I've seen a picture of just a goblin in a dragon costume, and I was like, this is so amazing. So basically, I was like, what if a goblin would believe he's a dragon and wear a dragon costume and walk around in the Underdark and be like, hey, I'm a dragon, give me respect. And then people are like, what? No, you're not. Yeah. And then
We also have one of our friends is playing Ebreek, a kobold trap maker. Full disclosure, I didn't read his backstory, but
I do. He's basically he lives basically in a community of other kobolds that live kind of like in a forest. He's almost kind of like a hunter, but his class is actually a rogue. And so far, he seems to distrust every other people in the party because they're all insane. Like Kumat kicked another party member's character we haven't talked about before, which is basically he's a Gripply, which is he's the smallest person of the party.
He's like a tiny little tree frog.
Yeah, and he just basically, what's the thing you said to us, like when you kicked him, like
because we our characters it was important for us to disclose our height and weight. Kumat is he's 6 foot tall, 210 pounds, with like a really huge strength score. And Klimmer, this frog that I kicked, is like 2 feet tall and 85 pounds. And when I Googled it, it's like roughly a 1 year old. And I punted him, and it knocked him unconscious immediately.
Eight damage, that's all his HP. He was unconscious. Yeah.
So I knocked him unconscious immediately.
Just because he was like, excuse me, sir, I would like, poof.
Hilarity ensued. But,
it was hilarious. But yeah, we're going to talk more about that later. So basically, Ebreek, I guess, I don't know exactly. Yeah,
I haven't seen a lot of what he's done so far, but yeah, he seems really suspicious, seems more like a stereotypical kobold.
It seems like he's going to be probably the most useful person in the group because he knows how to get food in the wild. Like, Grimmel is sort of okay at it, but he still sucks. And, of course, we already talked about Herman Klimmer the Frog. Like, I don't know. Like, he has a billion names. He sounds like he has, like, a fucking German name, but he acts like an Australian accent. And the icon for Klimmer is, like, the derpiest fucking frog you'll ever see. He looks so dumb. But, you know, he's an alchemist frog, so he can create potions and shit, and he's going to be probably
bombs.
Yeah, the healer. And, yeah, so crazy shit happened. So basically, I guess now we'll go to the story. How this story started is basically all of us kind of like...
There's also Tuskar, but he's being played by a GM at this point. I think.
Yeah, no, he's not quite a shaman. He's basically... I think he has psi powers. I don't know exactly which class he is. I think it's psi warrior or something. It's kind of weird, but he's an orc, basically. And I did mention it because I guess he's played by the GM, because what we do is we have a rotating GM. So basically the dungeon master changes... after adventures. So basically you have a character that the GM controls and kind of like pretend that, you know, he works with the group and stuff. So when I'm going to be the DM, you know, he's going to fully play his character. Tuskar, which we almost forgot. We don't know much about Tuskar yet.
Yeah.
I guess now we're going to talk a little bit about the story and how it all started. So of course we all have different backgrounds. Grimmel's background is that basically... He's coming from the surface, from a place in our previous campaign called the Velkarta Jungle that's controlled by orcs, and randomly, because he's an idiot, like, just after he basically went on a raid to kill, on a caravan, which happened to be from a theater troupe, which basically had tons of costumes. It was a gnome troupe, so basically they had a dragon costume, and Grimmel was like, this is it, this is me, I am a dragon, or something, and then basically, as he came back, he fell down a hole because I guess it was in the brush and he didn't really see where he was going. So he fell down a hole. He landed on another dead goblin that kind of like cushioned his fall a little bit. Then he looked up and he was like, hey guys, I fell down a hole. Please help me. And then nobody answered, and then he heard them being slaughtered. So as he did that, basically, he turned around and noticed that there was like this big, evil, worm creature that was just, like, looking at him, and it basically, like, paralyzed him and ate him. Like, I did give a good fight. Like, I jumped over, like, the big wall of slime that it left behind, because as a goblin, I have lots of agility, so I kind of, like, jumped over his fucking... And I thought I was maybe going to escape, but, of course, the creature, like, just ate me. But luckily, a group of tengus, which are like bird people, and of course I was like, ha, bird people on the ground, they must not be really smart, but regardless, they basically killed the creature and harvested me from its stomach, and I guess captured me as a slave. And I guess you want to tell, I guess, Viri and Kumat's story, since they're kind of like...
Yeah, I mean, I've been pretty, like, I haven't really told the group my story to sort of keep it for RP, but... Kumat,
yeah, you can be vague. You can stay vague. We'll discover.
That's okay. So Kumat again is a like on the surface bugbear. He lived with a tribe. Bugbears are like pretty young. He does have an older brother. Being bugbears, they just like ran around killing things. Eventually, pretty much. A troglodyte, which is sort of like a big stinky lizard person. Spellcaster slew a bunch of the bugbears and then imprisoned lots of other ones to start selling them off like on auctions in the Underdark.
I just want to say, like, you could talk just about what happened, like, in the adventure, or why you're, like, employed by Viri.
Yeah, so, and yeah, anyway, so he got sold off, eventually being sold through various slave markets, ended up being like a household minion of Viritutia, if I'm pronouncing that correctly.
Yeah. Or Viri, which is...
Viri. She left because I believe that her mother was trying to like use her as like a brood mother, if I'm not...
Or well, she wanted to marry him with like another noble to make an alliance or something, and she left with you because she was like, fuck that. And basically, as she was trying to survive in the forest, she got ambushed by a bunch of elves from the surface that were masked or something, and then as she escaped, or I think they did sell...
We fought them. We fought them, yeah. And they just hit us with blow darts and sold us off to the Kenku or Tengu. That's nice.
Because she did succeed a bluff check where she said, I'm not the person you're looking for. I'm not the drow you're looking for.
Yeah. But you know? We got captured regardless because I attacked them. But yeah, and then we ended up at a camp run by a group of creatures, or... Yeah,
I guess I just want to say quickly, yeah. How, what's his name, Ibri got captured is basically, he went on a hunt and got captured by those same bird people, and Klimmer, I think it was basically the same, like, he was looking for a cure for one
basically,
of his brothers.
All of the party members got captured, we all enslaved. Had, like, our own little adventures, we all got enslaved by the Tengu.
But what happened as we arrived at the camp?
Yeah, so we were captured by a group of creatures called the Directors. They are some sort of like psionic. We've talked about it, and we've decided to include psionics in our campaign, which are sort of like mental or psychic powers. We were enslaved in some place called Camp 5. And actually, I missed the beginning of the session because I was late. So
yeah, but it's basically just a bunch of people arriving at the camp. So basically, Ibrik was captured with three other kobolds. And they kind of became friends, I guess. And so basically what happened is he tried to look around, he saw the other kobolds, kind of made friends with them, and that's what happened so far. Then a few days passed where he worked, and then I think Grimmauld arrived. What Grimmauld did was kind of like trying to... Of course, the thing with Grimmauld is he only speaks goblin, so he doesn't speak the language that all the other people speak, which is undercommon, because he's from the surface anyways, and he doesn't have the intelligence score. So he was just walking around trying to figure out what he was supposed to do, and then orcs were like talking to him in the language he couldn't understand and tried to punch him or something, but he dodged because high AC, thank God for all that agility. So randomly he found a hut that I guess was, we found out later, was the hut of a healer that, you know, I guess would heal like the slaves as they were getting injured or something. And he some orc, which happened to be the character's, the DM's character, we found out later, threatened to throw him off the fucking stairs because he was coming in the hut without being injured. So then he wandered around more and found a group of goblins, which, and then of course he said, I'm Grimmauld, I'm I don't know, I'm a dragon or something, and then of course, like, because one of the boss of the goblins tried to steal his costume, he was like, fuck that shit, and he grew his claws and, like, clawed him, and then he was like, oh my, and of course, the chief of the goblins was like, oh, careful, he has long nails or something, and then Grimmel was like, I'm a dragon, you know, like, let's, and then all the goblins, like, believed him, were like, oh my god, he really is a dragon, that's amazing, let's all do everything he says, and then, of course, Grimmel was like, yes, let's do this. and then of course I think at this point kind of like Viritisia arrived at the camp with Kumat. Of course Beard wasn't there, so Kumat kind of just like followed Viri, and Viri was being like, this is all a mistake, I shouldn't be a slave and all that stuff, and she tried to basically talk to Tengi.
She seemed more bothered that it wasn't well run than the fact that she was enslaved.
Yeah, like, she kept being like, this is, I guess it was kind of like her trying to trick them, like,
yeah, like, you don't even know how to no more.
Like, yeah, I know your job more than you as a slave. You should put me in charge.
I actually, that's the thing, is that I didn't take it as deception. Like, I thought she was honestly just like, well, I was going to be captured. I wanted to be captured by the best. But, yeah, so there was a little bit of, like, we were wandering around the slave camp, figuring out, like, what was what.
And they gave us jobs.
Yeah, so some of us do mining and stuff. The healer... The Gripply healer, another frog woman that was all scarred, was basically directing a few of our party members as to how to escape. We all ended up meeting up at this healer's tent, coincidentally, to talk about what we would end up doing. That's basically where I kicked Climmer. Like, that's how we all ended up at this healer's hut, was because, obviously, I got the shit kicked out of me.
The two people, because when we did our job poorly, basically, the Tengu would whip us. Like, I think Grimmel whipped once, but basically, it was Kumat and Viri that both got the most whipping.
Yeah.
Viri, because she was being a fucking goofball, and
Kumat, because he's a monster.
Yeah, he's basically a monster, like, I'm, you know, about to kill everyone, and then he just whipped him to death or something, so he wouldn't.
So, yeah, so, in between, basically, Drew, our current Dungeon Master, was having us carry out various tasks through it, sort of a giant air quotes day and night cycle.
Yeah.
Of, like, when we were working during the day, we would earn food, and then when we were during the evening, we could sort of free roam. Yeah,
we would work, and we had chances to, like, either talk with people to help with our escape plan, which was basically they were digging a hole in the hut of the healer and hiding it with stuff. So basically, it was Ibrik who was digging that hole. Grimmel, on the other hand, was kind of, like, trying to ferment his own revolution. Of course, all the goblins would follow him because they were like, he's a dragon, he's going to get us out of here. And, of course... Grimmel, in his mind, at first, was like, yeah, I'm totally going to escape. He tried to talk with the kobolds, but of course the goblins in the camp earlier did steal the camp of the kobolds, so they were kind of pissed at goblins, and they didn't really believe Grimmel, surprisingly, when he said he was a dragon, and they didn't want to join the revolution effort. But still, the goblins believed in Grimmel, and they were like, hey, boss, we're going to do... stuff for you. So Grimmel said, yeah, we have a plan to escape. Bring us food and stuff so that the plan might be successful. And of course, then they were like, okay, what's the plan? And then Grimmel said, it's better if you don't know, because then if the orcs beat you up, you won't tell. And I got a nat 20, so the goblins were like, which is an automatic success, so they were like, yeah, that seems perfectly, that seems like a good plan. And of course, they brought us tons of food, so we just wouldn't starve to death. Of course, as we escaped in the hole, Grimmel abandoned them because he doesn't really care. He's just that kind of a dick.
Yeah, so to sort of summarize with that bit of time that we have left is that the healer Gripply is like a flesh stitcher. She's some sort of class where she can like stitch on other parts of creatures to her. She's stitched on these ants' antennae as part of like her master plan that she had before we arrived to contact some sort of like psychic ant creatures in order to help us burrow out of the encampment, which we did. We've sort of been running away from them, like fighting some monsters and stuff. And I just wanted to touch on really quick this sort of introduction, because I think it's really unique. Not only the campaign world is being unique, so you sort of have to think about something beyond, like, oh, you all just, like, stumble into each other. Imprisonment is a great way for a new party to... shit, I wish I could remember that term right now, but I've been drinking. it gives them a sense of agency. That's what I was looking for, because you have a common goal. So four creatures that would normally just beat the shit out of each other on sight, it works really well to have all of us work together through a common foe. Many campaigns start this way. To any DMs that are thinking about making your own campaign, it's a great way to do so.
Prison Escape.
Yeah. Again, it was great. If I had any sort of recommendation, just to sort of touch on it for other GMs, like sort of brainstorming or whatever, again, I believe I've talked about one of the campaigns that's probably my favorite is Dark Sun, which has an immense emphasis on slavery and actually has an entire book that just talks about slavery. It's something that you have to be very cautious about and think about very well, because generally what you're trying to, the emotion that you're trying to get across is this feeling of hopelessness and anger without it becoming boring and tedious, which is actually very difficult. It is quite the line to draw. My recommendation actually is not unlike what Drew did, but would have been something, almost think of it like a board game where there's a certain number of points that you have to accumulate without, like, in time so that you can escape without raising enough heat. Yeah. With failing. And I think that in this circumstance, again, when we were talking about in an earlier episode when metagaming is appropriate, is to let the players know certain choices that you make will raise, like, a, for lack of a better word, like heat or suspicion score. And the amount of things that you prepare, or even number of resources that you accumulate, you could say, instead of like a ambiguous points thing, you could say like you have X days of food that you have to collect, or you have to have X amount of, again, air quotes, like muscle, like a number of people to help you escape, and they have to accumulate these things without raising enough suspicion. Yeah. Otherwise, the quest fails. And again, you can keep it very lenient, very open, and I think that it's a fun, interactive way to get things together, and again, to impress upon the group that, again, they don't want to be enslaved. It's not like something that's a little joke, because one thing that does happen, and I do sort of feel like it did happen a little bit last session, is that sometimes PCs can escape slavery without it really feeling like it's just like, oh, and then we escaped, right?
Yeah.
It feels like the Elder Scrolls opening sequence of, like, then you were in prison, and then you were free, which, I mean, not always bad. It's good to keep pacing up. If anything, it's better to quickly run through something than to slog through it, because one of them's boring and one of them's silly. So that would be my recommendation, is to sort of let the players know, like, hey, this is how many days you have to wait, or this is the resources that are at your disposal, and here is your sort of failure requirement.
Because if it seems harder to the players, then it feels like a bigger accomplishment once you succeed. Like, for example, before Grimmel discovered about the hole in the healer's tent, he just wanted to storm the guard's tower with all his goblin buddies, and that's why he talked to the kobolds, because he wanted more people to go with him and just storm the tower, which, you know, might have been interesting, I guess, if it happened, but the kobolds were like, nah, fuck you. which, honestly, as a player, I don't blame them, because I wouldn't follow Grimmel anywhere.
Yeah, well, and again, but otherwise, I thought it was great. I think that, again, if there's anything other GMs could take away from it, it's that sort of situations like this, like in my prison sequence in our Oakwood campaign, and like this slave one, it's great that you can come up with sort of unique, very different NPCs that you wouldn't normally run into and put them into these sorts of situations with particular skills that can assist the party in unique ways. That's pretty much...
All right, so two last things before we finish. First is a comment that I'm going to read, but first, there's a picture I forgot to show that is just, I guess, generic. So it just says this, basically, the difference between jokes and hate speech. So he says, joke, the example is a poster of Mario that says, don't be racist, be like Mario, he's an Italian plumber created by Japanese people who speaks English and looks like a Mexican.
Oh my god.
Jumps like a... and then somebody adds under... this jumps like a black man and grabs coins like a Jew. and then the text says, humor and irony are very important to break ice on taboo subjects by diminishing the fear to speak about it. People don't like subjects that are taboo because excessive control and censorship of something hints that there might be something to hide. And then they show actual hate speech, which is an actual event that happened, where in a Jewish cemetery, people drew swastikas and SS signs over every single tombstone. And then,
headstone, yeah.
Yeah, headstone. The picture says, actual hate is another thing. It creates more fear instead of trying to make the subject less weighty. By comparing jokes to the above, you give the impression that you have ulterior motives and agendas. And of course, when you compare just innocent jokes that people make to actual, you know, fucking people drawing swastikas over headstones, I mean the difference seems more obvious. And I guess then again, the last comment, it was again by Mighty Sky Wizard, who says, Lola was thinking of another hunting game. Ghostmaster came out on PC early 2000, and then he says that the game on Genesis that I was talking about is a hunting starring Poltergeist, which I think, I'm pretty sure it's that.
Poltergeist.
Yeah. And I guess they called him Poltergeist because they wanted to create a mascot or something. Just like, hey, he's going to be as popular as Sonic, I tell you, boy.
Everything that came out was, remember, fucking Battletoads.
Yeah, in that era, yeah, it's like, I want to create a mascot. Oh, Battletoads was the best game ever. Fighting amphibians.
Okay, all right, hold on. I just did this test with somebody else who was like, man, I love Battletoads. Battletoads are wicked. Matt, I would like you to name all of the Ninja Turtles. Quick.
There's Raphael, Donatello, Mikey?
Oh, Michelangelo. No!
Michelangelo! What? It's Michelangelo! But they call him Mikey, okay?
Okay.
And, so I said Raphael, which is the purple one. No, it's the red one. It's the red one. Donatello is the purple one.
I did not expect this to just turn into embarrassing you all.
Donatello. No, sorry.
You were talking about not receiving enough hate mail.
Donatello, Raphael, Leonardo, and Michelangelo, okay? Fuck you. And then you want me to
now name the Battletoads.
There's Zitz.
That's what everyone says.
Zitz, yeah. And
Google it. Google it.
I forgot the two other ones, but I should.
Warts.
Yeah, Warts and some other bullshit name.
Yeah. So there you go.
Are you saying that they're a ripoff of Ninja Turtles? Like,
well, yeah, and that it's like, not as cool because no one can fucking name. Everyone like remembers. Oh, the first level is walking along cliffs. The second level is you're on a surfboard and it's shitty. The second level you're anvils in a fucking tunnel and then you're on surfboards and it's hell.
And then I forgot the rest because it's impossible to beat. It's not that good. But of course, you know, of course there's tons of other shit that is derivative from Ninja Turtles, like that fucking show where there's space rats on motorcycles. Yep. And of course,
Street Sharks.
Fuck yeah, Street
Sharks. Name either.
Yeah, anyways, that's all, I guess, for this week. Again, if you did like our story about Dungeons & Dragons and you want us to keep every single week talking about what happened in our adventures, if you think it's fun, tell us. If you're like, it's boring, you can also tell us.
Yep.
I guess that's pretty much it.
The only other thing is that, again, if anybody has like a better something that we think will stick better than Anti-Gamer, if it is something that a lot of people find derivative and think that it hurts our cause, we'd like to hear that too. Again, thanks to everyone for your comments so far. We really appreciate all the love, all the hate, all of it. We'll never disable our comments, even if it's harassment. Thanks, folks. We'll see you next week.